is Channel 7's Big Ten Ticket with Don Shane and Bo Schembechler.
Hello, everybody. College football is back with controversial rule changes and lots of intrigue. Both Michigan and Michigan State, big favorites to win today. And back to talk about those games and a whole lot more is Bo Schembechler. You're looking good.
Well, thank you.
Time off is
hanging in there.
You're hanging in there.
I'm a year older, though.
Yeah, you know? Well, and maybe even wiser than you've been in the past, and we're looking forward to that. Hey, Michigan's 26-point favorite. Michigan State's 29-point favorite. First game of the year, it's kind of like, I guess, throw yourself out there and see what happens.
Well,
and try to learn something,
yeah,
huh?
How do you do that? How can you rate teams so quickly? I think Michigan State will probably beat Idaho by 29, but Michigan against Vanderbilt. Vanderbilt is a much stronger team than Idaho, so I think Michigan will have a pretty good tough game.
Very disappointing season last year for Michigan. Do they come in with an, all right, we got a lot to prove, kind of like feeling, and we're going to show everybody that we are the elite program that we claim to be?
I think they've... I think they proved that in the way they practice. They're a much more physical, tough practicing team. And to me, that leads to a stronger football.
Well, that's your philosophy. And in the past, Lloyd kind of laid off word about injuries, right?
Well, I played with 95. He's playing with 85. He's worried about injuries. And I was worried about my team being tough enough to win. And I think what he's finding out is what I found out, that tough practices just make you more tougher physically, and you don't get as many injuries. But when you don't practice tough and all of a sudden you get these collisions, you end up with some sort of an injury. So I think there'll be a tougher physical team with less injuries.
Michael Hart had a fantastic freshman year. Last year, not so good. Injuries, offensive line problems. Are we going, do you think, see the Michael Hart that you saw as a freshman this year?
Yes.
Why?
Because I think he's healthy enough to do it. And I think that, and you may laugh at this, but he's being pressed by two other guys that are really, really good tailbacks.
Right. Well, he was pressed a little by Grady last year, who did some things.
Grady is 10 pounds lighter, quicker, reads the hole better. Grady is a pretty good back, and they can use him. And there's this freshman kid that I liked a lot in practice.
Chad Henney, same thing you could say about what I said about Michael Hart. Great freshman year, everything went well. Had Braylon Edwards, no Braylon last year. Offensive line problems, not as good. Do you think we'll see a return of form of this guy, or are you concerned about him?
Well, I'm concerned that the expectations, once again, will be too great for him. Because he's not going to hit all the passes. He's just not that kind of a quarterback, but he'll hit enough of them, and he'll run the team. He'll be a little more demonstrative, I think, and a better quarterback. But I think the expectation with all of us was, when he goes back to pass, there's a guy out there open.
He's gonna hit him.
The ball's got to be there, and you catch it. You know.
Right.
But he was a little inaccurate
last year. Yeah.
And
certainly.
He's probably still a little bit that way, but not quite as much.
All right. You know, when you go 7-5 in Michigan, that is unacceptable. You consider making changes, and Lloyd Carr did just that. Coaching changes, style of play changes. I don't know. Will it all work? We shall see. Can they win the Big Ten? Possibly. Can they get to the Rose Bowl or other BCS bowl game? Maybe. Tom Lydon has talked to Lloyd Carr and his players about their expectations with all the changes.
Every season opener brings a certain level of excitement, but this year's date with Vanderbilt provides the extra opportunity to start flushing away all those memories of a 7-5 season. If there's one thing the players learned from last year, it's that you get no second chances. You have to seize every opportunity. And the first one of 2006 comes today.
You try to forget about it, but, you know, it's always there. You know, adversity makes you stronger. You just really want to try to persevere through that. And, you know, we let some situations get us down, but, you know, we're not going to let that happen this year.
You don't get a chance to do it over. You get one chance per week. And if you want to be a championship team, you have to take advantage of those 12 opportunities.
The reins of the offense have once again been put in the hands of Mike DeBoer, the same guy who called the shots during the 1997 championship season.
He wants to the tempo early in the game, and that just shows you that, you know what, if we come out and we just, you know, punch him in the face running down the field, then just shows that we're a tough team, you know, and that we're going to be able to run the ball this year. Last year, we couldn't do that. You know, every time they put 9-10 in the box, that we couldn't, you know, get them off the ball. We couldn't run the ball three times to get a first down.
And defensively, new coordinator Ron English hopes he can capitalize on his players' natural athletic ability.
He really coaches playing fast first, you know what I mean? I mean, you can execute, you can do this, you can do that, but without, you know, you don't play fast, it really doesn't mean nothing. He's aggressive, he's real passionate about the game, and he's not scared at all. He's not scared of nothing. I mean, that's what he teaches us. And that's how he coaches the safeties, that's how he coaches the defense.
Just how far the Wolverines go this year will largely depend on how soon the two new systems are implemented successfully. At the Big House, I'm Tom Lydon for the Big Ten Ticket.
All right, one more thought on Henny. If something happens to him, and you don't wish that obviously on anybody, are they in big trouble if Henny can't play? I guess the answer is yes. Just by your expression, you're about to cry.
You see me rubbing my hands as you said that? I didn't say anything, but I...
Maybe the biggest concern on the team going into the season, right?
I think that's accurate. And, you know, it's kind of sad that Gutierrez left the squad.
Right.
Because with him here, then this team, in my judgment, would be the favorite to win the Big Ten.
And in your mind, the changes to board English had to be made?
Everything. I don't say they had to be made. I'm saying that what I've seen out there has been impressive to me. The way they coach, the aggressiveness, the upbeat of the practice. They're practicing much tougher, much better than they did a year ago.
Okay. Bo and I are just getting started. When we come back, we will talk about the Spartans. They open against the Idaho Vandals, and head coach Dennis Erickson, who was the head coach there years ago, and John L. Smith was one of his assistants. If you haven't heard, there have been some significant rule changes in college football. We'll get Bo's opinion on those changes, and I'll explain why this car wash was so important to Lloyd Carr and so helpful to so many people. That and more when the Big Ten Ticket returns after this. So please, stay right there.
Channel 7's Big Ten Ticket is brought to you in part by the University of Michigan Health System. Working together, that's the Michigan difference.
And welcome back to the Big Ten Ticket. Dennis Erickson has won two national titles, of course, not with Idaho, but with Miami. But now he is back where his career really started in the early 80s. MSU head coach John L. Smith, an assistant for Erickson back then, they face each other today. Our Vic Faust explores this friendship.
As if the excitement of the season opener here at Spartan Stadium wasn't enough, Coach John L. Smith will be facing the school in which he started his career and became the winningest coach in their program's history.
Yeah, there'll be some friends coming in. Friends that I grew up with, mainly. They'll be... My backyard will be full of cots. I've run out of bedrooms.
Idaho coach Dennis Erickson won't be sleeping in Smith's house, but the two are good friends. Smith coached under Erickson for 7 seasons, adding another storyline to the showdown.
We've been friends for years and always will be, and he's went his way in his career and I went mine, and but we talk, and we'll talk a lot more after we play this football game.
We schedule a game thinking I get to go against a former assistant, and now you get to go against your former mentor. And he's been our mentor offensively. So that's a little bit different.
The Vandals don't have a recognizable name nationally, but respecting Erickson as much as Smith does, he knows that Idaho will bring their A game.
We better be prepared, and we better come to the field with a serious state of mind and to show people that we're a new, different club.
Considering the way last season ended and the Spartans' 9-1 record during their last 10 openers, fans shouldn't expect to see anything less than state's best later today. With the Spartans in East Lansing, I'm Vic Faust for the Big Ten Ticket.
All right, we got to expand on this a little bit because nobody, and I mean nobody, faced a more controversial, different kind of coach-mentor coaching against each other than you and Woody did. So Talk about that and what goes through a guy's mind when they're playing the guy that really got him going in the business.
Well, it sounds like they've communicated.
Yeah, a little bit.
Woody, we never communicated. and so for 10 years, you know, it was, you could call it a strained relationship. It was no relationship. That's right. What it was.
Right.
And so let me tell you something. When you've worked a long time for somebody, there is nobody you'd rather beat than that coach.
Right. So that's exactly what John L.'s thinking, man. I want to beat this guy in the worst way possible.
Well, let's put it this way. Erickson isn't coming in there with Ohio State personnel. I mean, let's start with that. I mean, a victory over Idaho is not going to be a win over Ohio State.
Right.
So there's quite a bit of difference.
Okay, I saw you grimace when I asked you about Chad Henne, if something happened to him, where the Michigan team would be. Can the same be said about Michigan State? If something happens to Drew I can tell you, it's a problem, isn't it?
I have no idea what they have
behind
them.
Well, Stan's so good, though, right?
Who's their backup quarterback?
I don't know. They got a couple.
I don't know either.
But
yeah,
Stanton is a phenomenal player in your mind. You love
Stanton. I told you that I like that guy a lot as a quarterback. He's got all the attributes you want. Now, if they lose him, it certainly is going to have an impact on their team. If we lose Henne, it's going to have an impact on our team. Does it ruin our season? Maybe, maybe not. You know, I don't know that. But I do know that in both cases, they don't want to lose their quarterback.
John L. Smith is 18 wins, 18 losses, fourth season starting. That I can't say it can't be good enough for the administration, but I would assume that he is feeling a little pressure. Do you think so? And is your thoughts on him and the kind of season he has to have to be the coach there next year?
Can I say something?
You can say whatever you want. You've got a forum. Go ahead. Speak to the audience.
No, all of this, they all talk about this pressure on John L. Smith, pressure on Lloyd Carr. If Lloyd Carr doesn't beat Ohio State this year, he's going to be out. That's all people talking that have no clout whatsoever. They're just people out in left field coming up with signs. These are guys drinking beer in the tavern and arguing about this and that. Right. I don't like him as a coach. I don't like him. It means nothing. We're not going to fire Lloyd Carr. I would guess they're not going to fire John L. Smith. Now, he probably hasn't won as many games as they would like. But me as a coach, I would not fire him. On the base of what I see, how he coaches, and I think that they would probably feel the same way. But Don, all of this, every time I read this, that if Lloyd Carr doesn't beat Ohio State and win 9 games, I read that somewhere.
He's gone, right?
He's gone. We're not going to fool with that guy. Why, that's hogwash.
People better be careful what they root for, and they won't realize the kind of guy that they have.
That's
so
right.
He's not here anymore. Even with you, they said that, right?
And rightly so.
All right, John L. and Lloyd and all the coaches and players have to deal with some significant rule changes this season. And Bo and I will examine 3 in particular. You may have heard about them. They will shorten the game and cause coaches to rethink some strategy. That topic is next as the Big Ten Ticket continues. Don't go away.
I'm very reluctant to criticize the Rules Committee, and I won't do that. I do think the change in the starting of the game clock after a change of possession is one of the most significant rule changes in the last 50 years. And I think it's going to create a lot of scenarios at the end of games that are much different than what the fans and the players and the coaches are used to.
Lloyd Carr with some very strong opinions on the new rules changes. All right, let's talk about the one he mentioned first right there. Change of possession, clock starts when the 25-second clock starts, not when you snap the ball. Good or bad?
Bad.
Because?
Well, it makes you hustle. You got to hustle off the bench. And many teams don't huddle on that first anyway.
So they're going right out there to start the
play
anyway.
But you're still going to run some seconds off the clock. because that's a difficult thing to get it off right on, you know, immediately.
Right.
But I hey, this is television crap. That's exactly what it is, because they have. I'll bet you $100 that they figured out, well, we would like to have this game played within this period of time.
Oh, well, it's going to shorten the game.
Isn't that true?
It's going to shorten the game. We know that. Maybe by 10 or 15 minutes. Does it change a coach's thinking, strategy, scenarios, as he's talking about, drastically?
Well, I think not drastically.
Okay, but a little.
But he could make a mistake that'll make him look bad, and it's because he was thinking of was like it was like.
And in all likelihood, the fans may not realize all the things that are going on to know.
Tell me why that if I start a kickoff and I kick the ball off.
Oh, that's number two. Hold on a second. That's the clock starting.
Yeah.
Right? When you kick the ball, not when a return guy grabs it.
Now think. Who ever thought of that one?
I don't know who thought of it.
The ball is kicked off. The guy's toe hits leather. That's the only person that touches the ball.
Correct.
It goes over the goal line, and nobody touches it. It's not going to be returned. 6 seconds are off the clock.
Correct.
Well, now, why?
Well, plus it would bother me that, yeah, I understand. I don't know why.
I mean, I don't either.
How many times you kick it off? Well, if you score five or six touchdowns or whatever.
Yeah,
you're talking a minute
a
or a minute and a half, maybe, or maybe 2 minutes in the game.
You know,
that's significant.
You know, our guy kicks that ball good. That young Ryan kid, if he does it again this year, he puts that ball in the end zone.
Okay. Coaches get one instant replay challenge. Look at you. You get one instant replay challenge. If they're wrong, they lose a timeout. If they have no timeouts left, they can't challenge a replay. So, you know, you're okay with replay, but what about this challenge stuff?
Well, it's like the pros, except you.
Right.
They have three and you got one.
Exactly.
And that's tough, because when are you going to use it? There'll be some guys that say, well, no use in the first half because we're in the game and we may not, you know, need it to get ahead.
Right.
But in the second half, there's a bad call. I never had that. I never coached with that.
Correct.
But I can see what would have helped me in a few games.
Oh, Charles White.
Yeah.
That wasn't a touchdown.
No.
That would make your life a whole lot better right now.
And the guy wouldn't have to be very smart looking at the replay
That's
to know
true.
That wasn't
That's
a touchdown.
True. It wouldn't be any controversy on making sure that was the right call. All right, we've got one more segment to go. In a moment, you'll hear from Lloyd Carr on feeling anxious as the season begins, and we'll tell you about a terrific fundraiser in which he was involved. Bo and I come back with more of the tickets. Stay right there. As in the past, each week we will select a player of the game sponsored by the University of Michigan Healthcare System. Since we haven't played a game yet, we're going to go with Coach Lloyd Carr, and here's why. Lloyd was heavily involved, as were some of his players, in something called Carr's Wash for Kids. It took place in June at Michigan Stadium, all to benefit the Pediatric Bone Marrow Transplant Unit at Mott Children's Hospital. They raised $160,000. How good is that? And for that, Lloyd and his players are the players of the week. That is just a terrific thing. Over $300,000, by the way, over the last 3 years. He was in a very good mood doing that fundraiser. No pressure there, raising money for charity, very important to him, maybe more important than today's game. But we did ask him about the anxiety he faces going into today's opener.
I think it's exciting. I think that's the word. You know, General Eisenhower used to say, if you have any worries, tell them to your pillow. So I don't have anything to share with you about anxieties.
Did you ever talk to your pillow?
No. and I don't have a dog. Talk to my wife.
There you go. And that's a good sounding board, as always. A comment on Lloyd and that fundraiser and the kinds of things he does that very few people get to see behind the scenes.
Well, you know, he has that. And then he does the women's football camp,
mm-hmm.
and then he had the fantasy for grown-ups.
And he endows a scholarship.
And he endowed scholarships. He's taken care of his coaches, which he had to do. I honestly believe, Don, he's the most generous, head coach in college football today. And of course, people don't take that into consideration, but I do. And I admire him for it. I really do. I did some of that. It's not like I didn't, you know.
Right.
I did some, but I didn't have the money to play with. He did.
Right.
But he's the best.
We've touched on a couple of things with both Michigan and Michigan State as they approach the season opener today. The biggest, I guess, concern, first of all, that you would have for Michigan?
Injuries, particularly.
Coaches always say that, and that's part of the game. Well, I mean, I don't mean to doubt what you're saying, but you know what I'm saying.
Yeah, but I think Michigan could overcome some injuries, except at some positions. We talked about quarterback.
Right.
That would be a devastating blow to lose our quarterback. There are other positions where we're a little bit thin, but not many. And I would say that we could withstand an injury or two.
And if this team, I mean, as you look at the schedule, three games that really stand out, at Ohio State, at Penn State, at Notre Dame. To win all three of those would be just Herculean task, would it not?
Herculean?
Yeah.
We're the national champion. Holy smoke, you win those three on the road. I mean, what else you want to do?
Well, you better not mess up at home in the easier ones then, right?
Well, they're not all easy, you know. Iowa and Wisconsin, Michigan State, you're talking about good teams.
Right.
There's Michigan, Ohio State, there's four or five other guys right in there that'll challenge.
Indeed they will. Good to see you again.
Good to see
Looking
you.
For a great year.
Yeah, well.
Bo, as always, a lot of fun to talk with. Hey, thanks for joining us on the Big Ten Ticket. Enjoy the football games today. We'll see you next week.
Channel 7's Big Ten Ticket has been brought to you by the University of Michigan Health System. Working together, that's the Michigan difference.
Football Saturday of the season kicks off from fabled Michigan Stadium, the Big House. We're less than a minute away from the kickoff before the usual crowd of well over 100,000 on hand to watch the Wolverines host the Vanderbilt Commodores. Our coverage presented by cars.com. Michigan, led by Lloyd Carr, welcomes the dawn of a new season. The Wolverines 7-5 last year, their worst campaign since 1984. Sean McDonough with Chris Spielman. We'll be joined in a moment by Rob Stone. Chris, Michigan number 14, a lot of talent, determined to prove that last year was a one-year aberration.
Absolutely. This is something that they had to live with all year, and it's been a distraction for them. But they took that distraction, made it into a good thing. And today, Sean, they start their journey. Their actions can speak louder than words starting on this football field today.
One of the best return men in the country, Steve Breston, back to receive the opening kickoff. Vanderbilt won the toss and deferred, so Michigan will receive. And Brian Honfeld kicks off for Vanderbilt, down to Carl Tabb at the one-yard line. And he's taken down shy of the 20 at the 19. Tackled by Fontaine Hunter. A 19-yard return. Chad Henney, the junior, making his 25th consecutive start. He has started every game since game one of his true freshman season. He had good numbers last year, but the number most quarterbacks are judged by the wins and losses, and when they went 7-5, he took his share of the heat here in Michigan. One back, and it's Mike Hart through a big hole. Out to the 31-yard line. Gain of 12 on the first play from scrimmage. The Michigan starting lineup on offense brought to you by Nivea for Men. And Hart running behind a talented and veteran offensive line. They have four senior starters led by the great left tackle Jake Long, who's moved from right tackle to left tackle this year. The only new starter is Alex Mitchell, and they hope a healthy Hart will make a big difference as they try to bounce back this season as well. Quick throw by Henning. Out to Mario Manningham. And he's chopped down by Kevin Joyce at the 33, a gain of two. Vanderbilt last year during a very good 5-6 season, a bend but don't break philosophy. They hope to be more aggressive this year, led by the defensive captain, Jonathan Goff, one of the best junior linebackers in the country, and the hard-hitting safety, Rashard Langford, a freshman All-SEC player last year. On second down, it's Hart avoiding Joyce behind the line of scrimmage and tackled by Darren Speed after a gain of three.
Michael Hart is a difference maker. Last year where Michigan struggled when they lost Michael Hart, he's one of those rare players, especially at the running back position, where he can make players around him better because of his heart, no pun intended, and his determination on how he plays the game and runs the football.
He's sure-handed with two carries today, 420 consecutive touches without a fumble. His only career fumble back in his outstanding freshman year when he was the Big Ten Freshman of the Year. Manningham, the catch, trips down, and as a result, he'll be near the first down marker. He appeared to get it anyway. At the 41, Josh Allen was nearest Manningham. It'll be a first down for Michigan after a pickup of six.
Chad Henne, to me, Sean, I had a chance to take a look at some of the film of spring football last year. His growth, to me, is apparent. He knows where to go with the football, very comfortable in Mike DeBoard's offense, and having skilled receivers and veteran receivers back certainly is going to help him go.
There's Mike DeBoard back as offensive coordinator. He was the special teams coordinator the last couple of years. Both coordinators, offense and defense, changed this year at Michigan. Curtis Gatewood brought down Mike Hart after a 5-yard pickup. Lloyd Carr said that the previous coordinators, Jim Herman on defense, Terry Malone on offense, were not forced out. They left of their own volition. Both went to the NFL, but you also got the sense that after a 7-5 year change needed to be made.
It happens all over for college football. You take a look at Tennessee and Miami of Florida, same type of circumstances. 7-5 is not the typical record you want at Michigan.
Ford was their offensive coordinator in the late 90s, including when they won the national championship in 97. Henne on the rollout, nice throw and catch. Steve Breston, a first down into Vanderbilt territory at the 37-yard line. That's his 99th career catch, one away from the milestone. This one good for 17 yards.
Well, when you have speed, you can threaten a corner deep. Stevie gets the corner, shoulders turned, and that breaks off the route and comes back to the football. Thus, the corner, since his shoulders are turned, has no chance to break with the wide receiver. A good pass on the run by Chad Henne. Strike!
And the catch by the fifth-year senior, Breston. Here comes Hart again for another good hole. And he shows his strength and power as he ran over a couple of defenders to pick up another first down. Jonathan Goff finally got him on the ground after a gain of 11.
Take a look here at Jake Long, the All-American candidate for Michigan, who got a little bit thin this year, lost 20 pounds. Now watch how he brings his feet when he blocks and stays with his block. See, right there, good hand position, hands are inside, brings his feet, puts his man on the ground. And that's what I'm talking about, where Michael Hart will inspire his linemen to stay with their blocks longer, just like Jake did right there.
All right, again. Several big holes. He chose the one cutting back to the middle. And Curtis Gatewood made the tackle at the 22. Impressive opening drive for Michigan. They've used that 7-5 season as motivation since last winter. Mike Hart said when he was working out, needed a little motivation to finish a workout, he'd repeat 7-5, 7-5, and then do what he needed to do.
It's interesting that the contrast. Were 5-6, they were relatively happy down at Vandy, but 7-5 for Michigan, considered a losing season.
Hart stacked up by Jonathan Goff and Chris Booker at the 20-yard line, perhaps just inside the 20. Vanderbilt 5-6 a year ago, but they have something to prove. Their players and coach Bobby Johnson said, we want to prove we weren't a one-man team last year. They had Jay Cutler, the SEC Offensive Player of the Year. He went on to the Denver Broncos as a first-round pick. Bobby says, I think we have more talent this year, even though Cutler is gone. Evan Grady at a tailback now. He has a first down. He has a touchdown, Michigan. Board some credit. There was a very nice mix of plays on that drive, and if they're trying to prove a point and make a statement early, Chris, they just did it.
Well, absolutely, and you see Kevin Grady, when he ran through the hole, he was untouched. They would have got him if it was flag football, but it was important for this Michigan offense to get off and get off early because of the struggles with the offense, especially in the running game last year.
Kevin Grady, a 19-yard run, capping a 10-play drive, the extra point by Garrett Rivas.
It's time.
This game is being broadcast in high definition on ESPN HD, presented by Pioneer Plasma. Ball smiles here at the Big House. Michigan goes 81 yards in 10 plays in less than 5 minutes. Kevin Grady, one of several Michigan players, is in better shape than a year ago.
That's from Lloyd Carr's mandate of losing weight. They were too fat. Kevin Grady was about 235 last year. He's down to 215, and he showed it on that touchdown run.
Alex Washington returning the Ross Ryan kickoff, and a good return by Washington. Tackled by Charles Stewart at the 34-yard line.
Fat F-A-T, Sean, not the P-H-A-T.
Not P-H-A-T. Well, they're hoping Chris Nixon is PHAT, the successor to Jay Cutler. Saw some action last year, appeared in 5 games. Different quarterback, obviously, from Cutler. Nixon, they hope, a dual threat run and pass. Sophomore from Brundage, Alabama. They had 3 candidates in preseason to be the starting quarterback and take the place of Cutler. Nixon's the one. Throws it out quickly to the great receiver, Earl Bennett. And they take him down at the 37. Leon Hall and Jamar Adams rallying to Bennett. The Vanderbilt offensive starters brought to you by Nivea for Men. And we spotlight Earl Bennett. 79 catches to set the SEC freshman record last season. Finished the year with 16 receptions against South Carolina, 13 against Kentucky, 14 in their win at Tennessee. Marlon White, a juggling catch short of the first down at the 42, shoved out by Jamar Adams, a part of the Michigan defense, a veteran bunch with a couple of stars. Ron English, the defensive coordinator, thinks Lamar Woodley should dominate as a senior. And Leon Hall, one of the best technicians he's coached at cornerback. Third down, a long 2. Quarterback draw for Nixon, and he has the first down and more. He's a sturdy 215 pounds, and he introduced himself to the Wolverine defenders as he bounced off a couple to spin to the 47, the 11-yard gain.
Michigan's in a 3-3-5, so that leaves a 6-man front, which leads open holes because you've got more men to block than they have defenders. Excellent call by offensive coordinator Ted Kane to put Chris Nixon in a position to succeed.
Nixon out of Pike County High School in Alabama, former Mr. Football in the state of Alabama. A lot of the perennial powers in his neck of the woods, Auburn and Alabama, recruited him as a defensive back. Kason Jackson Garrison, the ball carrier, to the 45. Bobby Johnson told Nixon, if you come to Vanderbilt, we'll give you a chance to be a quarterback. He was a man of his word, and here is Nixon, the starter quarterback.
Well, I'll tell you, the second pass he completed on third down was where he stood in the pocket and he showed his guts and his leadership ability by taking one for the team and delivering an outcut. A great thrown ball, accurate, on time, and on target.
Coaches say he is a good runner, but he can also make all the throws. It's just a matter of gaining experience. That's the only thing they think he's lacking. Fake the handoff and plunged ahead for a yard. They'll bring up third down, and we welcome in Rob Stone.
Well, with Jay Cutler's departure, the Vandy three-man quarterback battle was kept secretive to the last possible moment by head coach Bobby Johnson. He wanted a little kind of a surprise factor for this game versus Michigan, but coach knew it, the player knew it, and Michigan had a hunch it would be Nixon. In fact, they made a tape of all of Nixon's plays from last year, and they are anticipating some spread offense coming their way today.
It was a surprise, but not really a big surprise, that Nixon had won the battle and would be the starter today. Third down and six. Vanderbilt tried to answer the Michigan score. Nixon in trouble. He got away from Terrence Taylor. And the pass incomplete. Batted away by Chris Graham, the middle linebacker.
Again, though, if you're Vanderbilt, you take a little bit of something from this. You got a first down. You had an opportunity where Stephen Bright had a chance to catch the football, missed his opportunity. And if Vanderbilt wants to be in this game, they got to make those opportunities to convert first downs from third downs when they have their shot.
Steve Breston, all-time punt returner in Michigan history, back at his 10-yard line, waiting for the first career punt from Brett Upson, a true freshman out of Spalding High School in Griffin, Georgia. He has a great leg. The coaches say he's been a little bit inconsistent in their preseason workouts. Breston down to his knees at the 12. A 31-yard punt. Michigan back on offense, leading 7-0 when we come back.
ESPN's College Football is presented by Cars.com. Find the right car for you, Cars.com. And in part by Seductively Smooth, new Heineken Premium Light.
We're back at Michigan Stadium. This will be the 194th consecutive home game with a crowd of at least 100,000 in the Big House, dating back to 1975 here at the University of Michigan. First and 10 Wolverines. The handoff to Mike Hart. Another good cutback and another big run. Mike Hart all the way out to the 31-yard line. A gain of 18. That's already 56 yards rushing now for Mike Hart. Sean McDonald with Chris Spielman. And Chris, you couldn't have envisioned, if you're a Michigan fan, a much better start than what we've seen on offense.
No, I think it's important. We talked to Coach DeBoard yesterday about how important it was to get going off on offense early. They got everybody involved. They got Michael Hart involved, Breston involved, and Chad Henne's looked sharp. You couldn't ask for a quicker start and a better start for Michigan.
They stick with Hart, and he plunges ahead to the 34-yard line. Let's head back to the studio. Here's Reese Davis.
Sean, the post-Vince Young era is underway at Texas. Colt McCoy completed his first pass, and on the third play from scrimmage, completed his second. A 60-yard touchdown strike to Lima Swede, and the champs are on top of North Texas 7-0 early.
Here at 7-0 Michigan, Wolverines an impressive 81-yard drive on their opening possession. That looked like a lateral and will be ruled a lateral out of bounds at the 30-yard line as Henny's throw was too high for Steve Breston. Henny was 2 for 2 on the opening drive for 23 yards. And when we spoke with Lloyd Carr and Mike DeBoard yesterday, they said they could notice the difference in Henny. Now that he's an upperclassman as a junior, he's not the young player in the huddle trying not to screw up for the older guys. He's taken charge of the huddle.
Well, and you started to see that a little bit last year, especially when they lost Mike Hart, but even more so this year because guys are starting to look to him for answers as opposed to he looking to the other guys for answers just by who he is and the nature of the position of quarterback.
Third down and 11. Vanderbilt a four-man rush, and the throw is over the head of Mario Manningham. Ben Koger had the coverage, and he had time, but his pass sailed over the head of the speedy sophomore Manningham.
Vanderbilt then now comes back and regains a little confidence after getting it shoved down their throat. They come back and hold Michigan to three and out. and they already have confidence on the offensive side of the ball because they were able to move the ball a little bit against Michigan in their first series.
A new punter for Vanderbilt and now a new punter for Michigan as well. Zoltan Mesko with a big leg. Getting a chance today. He and Ross Ryan are basically still competing for the punting job. Mesko got a nice roll all the way down to the 25-yard line. 45-yard punt. 5.5 to go first quarter. 7-0 Michigan. We're back in Ann Arbor, Michigan. SEC Big Ten battle between Vanderbilt and Michigan. 11th meeting all time, first since 1969. Chris Nixon showing his athleticism, fumbles the football, and it looks like the Wolverines have it at the 33-yard line. And they do. Terrence Taylor.
See Terrence Taylor come from. Here's Chris Nixon escaping Lamar Woodley, but he's got to put the ball away, secure it against your chest. You have people hustling from the backside. Ron English said, I want 11 Wolverine helmets to the ball. Well, he got 11 Wolverine helmets to the ball. Just a great hustle by Alan Branch, the big fella, 331 pounds, chasing the left from down the line of scrimmage, causing a turnover. Put that ball away, Sean. Put it right up there in your armpit, man. You don't want to have air. Air equals turnover.
Branch knocked it out. Taylor, a new starter, recovered. Michigan with a handoff by Henny to Hart. This time Jonathan Goff, the junior from Lynn, Massachusetts, was ready for him. No gain on the play. College football's kickoff weekend continues tonight with two games on ESPN at 5:30 Eastern, the much-anticipated battle. Number 9 Cal heading into Knoxville to take on the Volunteers, another team trying to regroup after a disappointing season last year. And then at 8:45, John David Booty takes the reins of the USC offense as the Trojans battle Arkansas. College football primetime tonight on ESPN. Freshman Carlos Brown is into the game. He gets the ball. He can fly. Mike Hart says he's the fastest running back he's seen in a long time. He's down to the 30. Let's check in with Reese.
All right, Sean, Taco Bell update in the freshly refurbished Kinnick Stadium. Iowa taking on Montana. Drew Tate finding Albert Young. This is the first time in the Ferentz era he's gotten his quarterback and leading rusher back. They hook up for a touchdown. Hawkeyes by 7.
Hawkeyes in the preseason Big Ten poll picked to finish third behind Ohio State and Michigan. Third down and 6 from just inside the 30. Henny under duress, sidestepped the rush, now has some running room. And he appeared to get the first down. Sean Dixon forced him out. Excellent downfield blocking to help give Henny time. And when we spoke with the Vanderbilt coaches, one of the things that impressed them the most about Michigan, the blocking of the wide receivers.
Well, again, blocking equals big runs downfield. It's a great job by Michael Hart coming right here, who's a check down player. He's going to come up and get the KO and allow Henny to scamper for the first down to cut off the backside pursuit. But anytime you get people blocking DBs downfield, that equals big gains as far as running the football.
7-yard run for Henny. First and 10, Michigan at the 22, leading 7-0. Here in the first quarter, errant pass in the direction of Steve Breston, and then he got walloped by Rashard Langford. And we spoke with Breston yesterday about the Vanderbilt defense. He said number 33 is a pretty good safety and a hard hitter.
Oh, he is, and he's usually in the Vanderbilt scheme, you have your strong safety. It's a lot of 8-man fronts as your most active physical football player. And I think it's safe to say that Rashard is that for the Commodores. And I'll tell you, Rashard, if he got there a little bit quicker, the pass was thrown behind, he might have had a pick 6.
Second and 10, it's hard again. Shoddy tackling on the far sideline by Vanderbilt. Finally, Ben Colger got him on the ground. But Hart picked up some additional yardage for a gain of 5 total.
You see Kevin Joyce there, and this is a problem. A lot of times tackling downfield isn't happening, but when you get receivers blocking downfield, staying alive and knocking guys into the popcorn section, you have a chance to get big plays. Again, little extra yards help, and it's all set up by effort on receivers' part to block downfield.
Another third down for Michigan. Third and four. Both coaching staff said missed tackles are a concern, particularly in the opening ball game. They don't do much tackling in the preseason. Trying to keep people healthy. Good throw, and then Manningham lost the football. Are they going to rule it a catch? The officials are now conferring. Looked like he had it and then lost it out of bounds. And they're going to spot it at the one. A catch for Manningham, and then a fumble. That was the right call, I think, Chris. Looked like he had possession, and then Josh Allen knocked it out of bounds.
It's a nice job by Josh Allen. I'll tell you, it's a great throw, and you see the height advantage that Mario Manningham has over Josh Allen. Josh does a good job of trying to rip the ball out of there. Interesting note, if that ball would have crossed that orange little cone there, gone into the end zone, turnover, touchback Vanderbilt.
The previous play is under review.
Bill Lemonnier is the referee. This is a Big Ten officiating crew working in the ball game today. First, this year, one of the changes in replay review is the coach is allowed one challenge per game. I don't think this was a challenge, even though we had the graphic up there. I think the replay official wanted to review it. There was no announcement by Bill Lemonnier that it was a challenge by Vanderbilt.
Again, that's close to me. Looks like he has possession. He turns his head when he catches the football. 1 foot comes down. One, two, fumble. That's a fumble. It's a break for Michigan again that he didn't fumble through the end zone. One, two, boom.
And he did have possession.
Yeah. And we had a lot of discussion in our offseason meetings about the instant replay, and every play is being reviewed in the press box by the replay officials. And so you don't have to have a coach's challenge. They'll call down and stop the game like they did on this previous play here to make sure that they get it right.
See Bobby Johnson indicating he thought Manningham was juggling it all the way, but it did look to us, at least, like he tucked it into his arm, and then the ball got knocked out by Allen. Of course, both coaches felt like they got victimized last year by some bad calls. There was very controversial officiating throughout Michigan's loss to Nebraska in the Alamo Bowl. And Bobby Johnson and Vanderbilt lost the late season game in overtime at Florida when Bobby Johnson wanted to go for two and they had scored late in the game in regulation.
We have indisputable video evidence. The pass is incomplete.
Wow.
Well, fourth down, fourth and four.
Well, we're 0 for 1 this year. Apparently Bobby Johnson was right. He was being juggled in the opinion of the replay official.
One. I'll tell you, it has to be, the word is indisputable, and I don't know if that's indisputable, but they look at it, and we are 0 for 1. It's close, very close, very close call.
Jim Augustin, the replay official. Well, that's a big break for Vanderbilt. Now it's fourth down. Instead of first and goal from the one, it's fourth and four, and Gabbert Rivas, the senior, will try a 33-yard field goal. And a very dependable kicker throughout his Michigan career. And he got the late hook on that one to give the Wolverines a 10-0 lead. 33-yard field goal by the senior from Tampa. Let's head back to the studio. Here's Reese Davis.
Okay, Sean, Michigan's arch rival, at least one of them, Michigan State taking on Idaho. Dennis Erickson back for his second stint as Vandal coach, and he had to watch Drew Stanton find Kerry Reed to put Sparty on top 7-0, getting late in the first.
And And we spoke with Lloyd Carr yesterday. He thinks Michigan State might be, if you're looking for a surprise team to contend in the Big Ten, it could be the Spartans. And we were talking about Bobby Johnson. They had a chance to win at Florida, and had they won that game, they would have gone to a bowl for the first time since the early 80s. They scored late in regulation. They were down by one. They wanted to go for two. Earl Bennett got called for a ridiculous unsportsmanlike conduct penalty for a little wiggle after he scored. So they had to kick a 35-yard extra point instead. Did not have the chance to go for the win and wound up losing in overtime.
Well, anytime that you bring a subjective view into it, it's tough. And the celebration rule, you and I were talking about this last night. You know, don't make a minnow out of a whale.
Bobby Gaston, the supervisor officials in the SEC, that's what he said. Live ball. And Dahlren Speed got on it quickly. He said, we're looking for whales, not minnows, in that excessive celebration penalty. Monday night, ESPN Full Circle, presented by the Dish Network, brings you Florida State, Miami. From every angle, ESPN will show the full broadcast of the game. ESPN2 has close-ups of the legendary coach Bobby Bowden, the quarterbacks and more, and ESPNU and ESPN 360 have Skycam, plus commentary from ESPN Radio's Colin Cowherd. So tune in Monday night at 8 Eastern. Just about any part of our ESPN family that you're involved with that has something on there related to the game. Nixon, his receiver was covered, so he pulled it down, lost the ball again, and no whistle. The Wolverines say they have another Nixon fumble in their grasp. They're going to rule Nixon down at the 31-yard line. He fumbled on their last possession to set up the Garrett Rivas field goal.
See the air between his arm. He's got to learn to protect the football. When a hit comes, right there is his knee down before the ball's out. And the ball popped out because of the ground. But you've got to have no air showing between your arm and the ball. And again, if you're going to get hit as a quarterback or anybody, cover it up with two hands. Protect it like your firstborn.
Jason Jackson Garrison. And then Alan Branch and a host of Wolverine defenders. It'll be third down and long. Jackson Garrison split time at tailback last year with Jeff Jennings. They combined for just under 1,000 yards. They threw the ball 65% of the time. Jackson Garrison should get a lot more action this year because Jennings might be out for the year with a knee injury.
Well, he's going to get some action. He's going to get popped today. Ron English, the new defensive coordinator in the Wolverines, is emphasizing play fast. And right now, this Wolverine defense is playing real fast because 11 helmets are getting to the football.
First year defensive coordinator took over when Jim Herman went to the New York Jets, and the ball dropped by Earl Bennett. He was open. It was a good throw. He would have had a first down out of the 45-yard line. Jamar Adams had coverage. There is a flag on the play back at the line of scrimmage.
One of the things that bothers me, and Earl Bennett's a great receiver, don't get me wrong, but when guys body catch the football, you watch great NFL receivers, even great college players, they go out and snag the ball with their hands, then bring it in. Less chance for error. Earl Bennett let that ball hit his gut, slipped right through. It's a great pass, though, Nixon to go. You got to be enthused a little bit if you're Vanderbilt and you're seeing Chris Nixon throwing strikes.
Talking about the penalty, it was a personal foul against Vanderbilt. Looked like Brian Stamper, the right tackle, had his hands
personal
up on the
foul.
Headgear.
Illegal hands to the face. Number 72 on the offense. The penalty's declined. Fourth down.
I don't think Tiger Woods taught him that, did he?
No, Brian Stamper from Windermere, Florida, lives close to Tiger Woods. He says he sees Tiger working out at Isleworth in the country club. There aren't a lot of college football players who can say I work out in the offseason at Isleworth Country Club.
Well, he tried to throw technique on Lamar Woodley. He went for the Adam's apple. Good call by the officials being on top of that. That's a nice little matchup we'll keep our eye on today.
Freshman Upson with his second punt. Preston muffed it. They throw a flag. And the ball goes out of bounds. DJ Moore was right in the face of Preston. Perhaps too close. He didn't think so.
Well, one reason why Stevie Preston will leave here, the all-time return man record holder, is the fact that he has guts. You got a white jersey bailing down on you, and you're not fair catching the football. I like
that.
Take your shot.
Charge to the kicking team. 15-yard penalty. Bottom of the foul. Automatic. First down.
Ooh, it's a bad call.
And close.
You look like a bad call to me. But Moore called for the penalty. And let's check in with Rob Stone.
Well, Sean, new Michigan offensive coordinator Mike DeBoer admits that they brought in some people to talk to them about revamping the offense, admits that they went someplace to study some other offenses, and admits at the end of this game, we will know that this offense is different. But despite our best prodding yesterday, he would cough up no details.
Steve Breston takes the swing pass, and Ryan Hamilton tackled him at the 48-yard line, perhaps the 49, a gain of 3. And a milestone now for Breston, 100 career catches. And that ends the quarter. And Breston continues to take his place among the list of great receivers here at Michigan. 10-0 Wolverines. Ann Arbor, Michigan, our college football coverage presented by Cars.com. The Wolverines leading 10-0 over Vanderbilt. They have the ball, second and 7 at their own 49-yard line. Chad Henney with the handoff to another freshman, Brandon Miner. He's had a terrific preseason. Lloyd Carr raving about Miner yesterday, and he made a positive impression on these fans with that first carry. Good for 24 yards.
Well, Adrian Arrington, number 16, the receiver's the guy that springs this out. And right there, Vanderbilt defenders have Velcros on their jerseys because the Michigan men are holding them and they're not able to get off blocks or make plays. And then when you have a guy like Brandon Miner who has a burst like he does, you get a big play.
Lloyd Carr said yesterday about Miner, he'll be a real asset this season. Action fake by Henning. Man wide open, and it's incomplete. Through the hands of the tight end, Mike Massey. And that was a touchdown if Massey was able to haul it in. Michigan scored a touchdown on its opening possession, took the opening kickoff on 81 yards, 10 plays, a 19-yard touchdown run by Kevin Grady. And Chris Nixon fumbled. Terrence Taylor recovered for Michigan, and that led to a Garrett Rivas 33-yard field goal. There's Meyer again. Ankle tackled by Chris Booker.
Well, much has been said about what Michigan is doing offensively different. This is the first touchdown by Kevin Grady. Alex Gibbs was brought in here this spring, and he put in a zone blocking scheme. And what that tells you is you can pick a hole if you're a running back between this part and this part, hit it and run, roll. Here he goes. Right there, you see the guys stay on their blocks, get, and they do not go upfield quickly. They stay and work a line and allow the running back to choose his hole of choice.
Alex Gibbs, just to clarify, not on the staff, brought in as a consultant, longtime Denver Broncos offensive line coach. Recently did some work with the Atlanta Falcons. Steve Breston a drop, and Henny being victimized by the bad hands of his receivers. Here's Rob Stone.
Well, Sean, we talked earlier just before the change of the quarter that Mike DeBoer, the new offensive coordinator, is going to do things differently. What we do know, adding to what Chris just said, is that formation-wise, the playbook has been scaled back, and the running game mentality is, quote, hey, try to stop us. Love that. We're going to keep watching this, and Chris, a little bit later on, decipher for us what some of the other changes are that they've employed.
42-yard field goal try now for Rivas. Chance to lead their team in scoring 3 years in a row. No points there. The kick is blocked. Jonathan Goff blocked it for Vanderbilt, and the Commodores will take over at the 41-yard line.
Well, if Rivas has a weakness, is that he line drives the kick. This ball is line drive because a defensive player should never be able to block a kick at the line of scrimmage. You need at least 3 yards of penetration. There's no penetration. You get a low kick and you get a rejection.
By Goff, the junior from beautiful Lynn, Massachusetts. 10-0. Big play by a big playmaker, Vanderbilt's Jonathan Goff. Blocked the field goal try for Garrett Rivas. Michigan controlling the game, but leading just 10 to nothing. A screen set up and incomplete. Nixon under duress as he tried to throw it to Kaysen Jackson Garrison. It's remarkable that Kaysen is playing in the ball game. He had an emergency appendectomy on August 14th, just a couple of weeks ago. But here he is back playing. He didn't have any contact in drills over the last week of practice since he returned to action. They're a little bit worried about his fitness level, given that he was out of action for a bit.
Well, he would have got real tired there, because that was 6 points, because Michigan was completely full. You looked at Vanderbilt to come back to that play later in the second half.
Nixon had a lot of time this time, but a completion to Stephen Bright, the fullback, for a short gain. Out across the 44. 3 yard pickup. Prescott Burgess made the tackle. Stats are not pretty for Bobby Johnson. Vanderbilt's been outrushed 119-26. And those pass numbers could be a lot worse for Vanderbilt had it not been for some key drop balls by Michigan receivers.
Yep. Stevie Breston had a chance for a big game and turned his head before he caught the ball. Eye on the ball.
On third down, Nixon has Bennett. He hangs on this time for a first down. Earl Bennett, the sophomore, tackled by Jamar Adams. Bennett's out of Birmingham, Alabama. 14-yard completion.
Nice call by Ted Kane. You remember on third down before, Earl Bennett had the opportunity to make the catch. They come back with the square in, about a 14-yard square in. And you'll see Chris Nixon step up into the pocket with confidence and hits Earl Bennett in stride. Still would like to see him use those hands, Sean, as opposed to letting it bounce off his shoulder pads. Cradle catch.
Tight formation, Wolverines blitz. Nixon has a quick hitter. And had Sean Walker been able to break the tackle of Charles Stewart, he had a touchdown. Michigan was blitzing, no more blue shirts out there. But Stewart made the play. It is a first down for Walker after an 11-yard gain.
One way to neutralize the blitz is to get rid of the football. That's part what Jay Cutler did down there last year. Chris Nixon's doing it now. They don't hold the football. They deliver it on time and get rid of it. The blitz is ineffective because you don't have enough time to get there. Great job by Ted Kane having these guys get rid of the ball early and on time.
12 and a half to go, first half. Michigan leads 10 to nothing. That's a lateral to Bennett. He is a man wide open. If it's on target and caught, it is a touchdown for Marlon White. Well, you mentioned Ted Kane and great play calls, and there's another. The lateral, Nixon out to Earl Bennett, and then Bennett to a wide open Marlon White for Vanderbilt's first score of the season.
Well, this is how they started the football game. They started with the screen. They set this up right here. You're going to see Earl Bennett step back. Nobody's covered downfield, and one way to take advantage of an aggressive defense, a little trickery or trickeration, as Reese Davis likes to say, never hurts.
Ryan Honfeld, the extra point up and good. Excellent job by Mackenzie Adams, the holder, on a high snap. Marlon White, the touchdown reception, the senior from Macon, Georgia, with Vanderbilt's first point.
ESPN's College Football, brought to you by Bex. Bex reminds you to step up, stand out, life beckons. And Alltel Wireless. Want to choose who you call for free? Get My Circle from Alltel Wireless.
Marlon White, the catch on Earl Bennett's first career pass. Excellent play call by Ted Kane. And the key to this improvement of the Vanderbilt program over the last 5 years, Bobby Johnson's done a great job keeping the staff together. They've had virtually no changes over the 5 years. Kane's been there with Johnson the entire time in Nashville. Good coverage by the Vanderbilt Commodore kickoff unit. as they drop Breston at the 16-yard line. Here's Reese.
Sean, Georgia and Western Kentucky, the Dogs' normal punt returner, Thomas Flowers, suspended for the first two games of the season, so Mikey Henderson, the junior, taking over the duties, and there he goes, setting sail for Mark Richt's team and goes into the end zone. Oh, forgot the ball! Reminiscent of Jerry Rice in the Superdome a few years ago. They looked at it, no touchdown, touchback. Henderson will have a chance to atone.
And he'll need it. That is hard to forgive. Mike Hart on first down, plunges out to the 21, a gain of five. Here's Reese again.
Sean, if you want to get back in the coach's good graces after dropping the ball, going in for a wide open touchdown, the ensuing punt from Western Kentucky, and there goes Mikey Henderson again. 67 yards, and this time Spielman, no air showing until he crossed the goal line.
Fundamentals, Reese. Fundamentals.
Looked like a clip, didn't it? Does Western Kentucky have 11 men covering punts today? What are they doing? Mike Hart.
They're all on top of the hill.
aren't
they the Hilltoppers?
Yes, they are.
There you go.
Donovan Goff made the tackle on Hart. The injury to Hart, really the biggest reason why Michigan wound up at 7-5. Lloyd Carson is one of the best football players I've ever coached. Not only for his physical talents, but he's a team leader. He played in only 4-plus games, hamstring and ankle injuries, and you wonder if there's some concern there as he's bouncing around a bit after that run. Kevin Grady comes in. Three wide receivers. Chad Henney, the quick strike to Steve Breston. Look out! Steve Breston banged out of bounds. A terrific run after the catch all the way to the Vanderbilt 45-yard line. 28 yards. Most of it on great individual effort by Steve Breston.
Yeah, this is because the corners are playing off. You see right there, he gets out. Stevie Breston catches the football. And this as the coaches, no, get upfield. Yes. Come on. Stevie Breston does his best, and he uses his run after catch abilities to make the most of it. Nice little shot there by Kevin Joy. This. Stevie Breston running, big lineman hustling downfield, and there's a close the gate in front of the ball.
First and 10, Michigan. They have to feel like they should have a bigger lead than they do in this game. Mike Hart looked like a promising screen, but the defense closed quickly. Marcus Buggs, the linebacker, junior from Madison, Tennessee, with a nice play in space. And here are some of those miscues, particularly the drop balls. We were talking about Manningham. That was ruled incomplete. They had to settle for a field goal. Massey would have had a touchdown. The pass wasn't perfect but catchable. This would have been a first down. Instead, they had to try a field goal, and it wound up being blocked.
Again, opportunities, and usually you don't see those drops by a guy like Stevie Breston. But again, it's the first game, so you're going to see a little bit of those mistakes happen early on.
Adrian Arrington spins out of a tackle. You asked all the coaches we spoke with about concerns in the first ball game for missed tackles, and that's particularly a problem right now for Vanderbilt as the junior Arrington spun very close to a first down.
You'll see speed come here, and watch what happens. He's going to go make the tackle, but he'll go to his feet. See? He didn't run through the ball carrier. He only ran to him. On contact, he dropped to his knees. A big cat like that's going to break through it. But if you run through the guy, you got a shot. You got to bring your feet when you hit. Don't go to your knees.
Sorry, Chris. Bruce Fowler, the defensive coordinator for Vanderbilt. Another coach who's been with Bobby Johnson back to their days at Furman. Third down and one. It's Grady. Great push at the line of scrimmage by that offensive line. Grady wasn't touched until they got to the 30. First down, Michigan. Ahead 10-7 with 9.5 to go till halftime. Marcus Buggs, the tackle.
Now, if you're Vanderbilt, you're all right. You want to make this a long football game. You want to be to the end. And we talked about a bend, don't break. They, in order for them to get pressure, they can't do it with four. They've got to bring blitzes and play soft behind. So that's a naturally bend tight defense. But if they can hang in there, get tough inside the 20-yard line, they have an opportunity in this football game.
Only 14 sacks all of last year for Vanderbilt, among the lowest totals in the country. 110 out of 117, 118. Mike Hart, the ball carrier. for the 26-yard line. College football's kickoff weekend continues tonight. Two games on ESPN, the Cal Bears into Knoxville to take on Tennessee, and then USC at Arkansas at 8:45 Eastern. College football primetime tonight on ESPN.
Tennessee has a little point to prove, don't they?
Yes.
Good game. Man, I love college football.
5-6 last year for the Volunteers, including the season-ending loss to Vanderbilt in Knoxville. The Commodores' first win in Knoxville since 1975. Henny is sacked. First sack of the season for Vanderbilt. Broderick Stewart. And we mentioned, Chris, the low sack total last year. A lot of it is because of what you said, the philosophy of Bruce Fowler. Doesn't want to leave his secondary on an island. They don't play particularly aggressively. They play bend and don't break and hope you make a mistake.
There's Broderick Stewart working on Jake Long. And you'll see Broderick Stewart's known for speed. He splits a double team, and it's a little bit of mix-ups between the tight end and Jake Long. And Broderick Stewart just keeps great effort. Come, not get discouraged by the double team. Jake Long's putting a bind. He can't take two. So Broderick says, okay, I'll get one.
Freshman from Noonan, Georgia. As they get better athletes into this Vandy program, and they are, they will be more aggressive on defense. Here they come after Henny. They didn't get him. Kevin Joyce missed. Henny out of bounds at the 32, well shy of the first down.
See, Mike Hart down there is yelling at the offensive line. And Mike's got to do his job. Somebody's got to pick up the blitz.
Bruce Fowler said, we have better athletes. We will be more aggressive this year. And there it was, Joyce on the blitz that forced Henny out of the pocket. Vanderbilt and Michigan. The last time they met was in 1969 in Bo Schembechler's first game as head coach of the Wolverines. Michigan won 42-14. Sean McDonough with Chris Spielman and Rob Stone. Delighted to have you with us. Michigan will try another field goal. The last effort by Rebus was blocked by Jonathan Goff. Right, this will be a 48-yard try, which would be a career long.
Got to get some air on it, though. There you go.
And it is good. The previous career long for Garrett Rebus was 47 yards. He had made a 47-yarder four times in his career. This one through from 48.
A better get off. The ball gets up in the air.
Michigan leads 13-7. The 127th season of Michigan football, 80th season here in the Big House for the Wolverines. They lead 13-7. They have certainly had a number of chances to have a wider lead. Ross Ryan will kick off after the longest field goal of Garrett Rebus's career. Alex Washington and Josh Allen back to receive it. It's Washington from the two. And down at the 20. Tackled by Anton Campbell. Here's Reese Davis.
Sean, Colt McCoy, the new Texas quarterback, has added a touchdown run to go with his earlier touchdown pass. And the Longhorns are dominating against the mean green of North Texas, 14-0 early in the second quarter.
No look ahead to your alma mater, apparently.
It'll be a great game. Rematch in Austin.
And some wondered if Michigan would be looking ahead to its third game of the year at Notre Dame. And if Central Michigan next. Well, a rare flag. There's been only one accepted penalty in this game. Somewhat of a surprise given it's a first game and frequently there are a lot of mistakes involving penalties, but these were the two least penalized teams in the country last year.
Discipline and coaching, direct reflection.
Prior to snap, number 88 in the offense lined up in the neutral zone. That's a 5-yard penalty, still first down.
We're back to the 15-yard line. These two teams penalized on average about four times per game last year. Michigan 4, Vanderbilt 4.2. And a penalty yardage first in the nation for Vanderbilt. Vanderbilt can penalize twice. The third penalty was declined by Michigan against Vanderbilt. Nixon in trouble and sacked back at the 8-yard line. Lamar Woodley with the first sack of the season for Michigan.
Sean, remember the screen pass where I said Kasem Jackson would get hurt or tired running the ball? They tried to come back to it right there. They should have waited till the second half because Prescott Burgess is all over it. Now Nixon's got to see that Jackson Garrison is covered. Throw the ball. Throw it at his feet. Don't take a sack, especially when you're down that deep into your own territory. It's a good job of recognition. Michigan, you know what I mean.
Yes.
Thank you. You're second. One of few.
Second and 22. Vanderbilt with an empty backfield, and Nixon, after he faked the handoff to Jackson, swung down again by Woodley. Ron English said Woodley can be a dominant player, and he's dominating right now. A loss of three more. Here's Rob Stone.
Sean, new Wolverine defensive coordinator Ron English's two primary goals sound like a movie title: the fast and the physical. Number one, play with speed at practice and in games, and be physical. And that's not talking about late hits. That's talking about tackling, getting bodies to the ball, laying punishment on the players so they don't surge for those extra yards. And in the film work, in a couple weeks when the opposition is watching them, they're going to be a little gun shy. So far, that film getting a thumbs up.
107,000 fans making plenty of noise. Third and 25. Just trying to get a little room for the punter, and they don't do that. David Harris tackles Kasem Jackson Garrison. Impressive stand by the defense of Ron English. Elevated a defensive coordinator after 3 years as defensive backs coach. He had actually accepted a job to be the secondary coach with the Chicago Bears when Lloyd Carr called him in and said, Jim Herman is leaving. We'd like to make you our coordinator. English elected to take that opportunity instead of going to the NFL.
It's nice to be wanted. I think it's a great choice that he stayed at Michigan to become the coordinator.
Brett Upson. Preston muffed it and got it back in his grasp, but they swarm him under at the 45-yard line. Always pressure on the quarterback here at Michigan.
You understand it as a quarterback coming here at a great university like Michigan with the traditional is all pride, and you just deal with pressure like you deal with any other way. Just take it in one way and just go out and play and just play to your capability.
And he aware that he took some of the criticism last year. Seems a little unfair given he threw 23 touchdown passes, only 8 interceptions, completed 58% of his passes. They played most of the year without Mike Hart and Jake Long. And he runs down to the 40-yard line.
Sean Finney kept the ball.
He's the son of a welder. His dad works in the Philadelphia shipyard. And his mom a dental assistant in the Philadelphia area. And they're a tough family. Chad has a tattoo on his arm. He said when he was in the eighth grade, as he showed us the tattoo yesterday, his parents took him to a tattoo party, and his parents encouraged him to get some body art. He said he would do it if his mother did. His mother got a butterfly tattoo. And Chad had their name, a family name, tattooed onto his arm.
Well,
Kevin Grady, the ball carrier.
Rashard Leonard just brought some ink and gave Nick Grady a tattoo. That was a great job by Rashard Leonard. You see why he was all SEC freshman team. Langford, excuse me. He's a good player, though. Man, he avoided the block and came with contact.
He was unanimous freshman all SEC last year. Defense had the crowd roaring here, but the offense hasn't done much with the good field position so far. Third down and 7. Deep drop by Henney. Lots of time underneath Preston with lots of running room. Shoved out by Josh Allen, but it's a first down for the Wolverines inside the 23-yard line.
One of the problems that Michigan was having was having a breakdown in pass protection. Well, when you have that kind of time and you have a guy like Stevie Breston running three, Chad Henney just bides his time, let the other receivers run him off. Breston catches the ball underneath and knows what to do with it after he catches it. Get that first down.
Four catches for 71 yards for Breston. Kevin Grady Inside the 20, the ball's on the ground.
Kevin Grady was the ball carrier.
Scrum it out, boys.
Commodores think they have it. They seem convinced.
Now, this is beautiful. This is where you start digging and grabbing for everything.
They seem more convinced than ever, and their belief is mirrored now by the officials. Michigan turns it over inside the 20-yard line on a fumble by Kevin Grady. Theo Horrocks recovered the fumble.
So Kevin Grady starts a trip before he gets there. And I'm not sure from that angle if Kevin Grady is not down. See right here.
It was close. Yeah. Curtis Gatewood appeared to get a hand on the ball, and then Horrocks recovered it. Of course, when Mike Hart is in there, Michigan never fumbles. I think that ball is out just before he goes down. We haven't seen Mike Hart in a while. It looked like he was hobbled a bit on the sideline a moment ago, and Rob Stone is working to find out if there's anything wrong with Mike Hart. 2:20 to go, the clock running on the change of possession, a new rule this year, and a sack again for Lamar Woodley. Nixon didn't see him till the last instant, back at the 11-yard line. Ron English said, we need Woodley to dominate. He's capable of doing it, and he's doing it right now.
Right here's Lamar Woodley, and what you're going to see is speed off the corner. And see what kind of, oh, he does a little slap rip, bends that shoulder, turns a short corner. The big fella has no chance when Lamar Woodley's coming after you. It's a great job of ball get off. As soon as that ball snapped, he's got a rocket coming out of his feet. Nice job.
He went around a very good tackle, Chris Williams, Jr. On the ground with Kason Jackson Garrison, and Michigan's going to call a timeout now. With Vanderbilt deep in its own territory, a minute 31. Left in the first half.
You know what Vanderbilt needs to start doing is going back to the quick passing game. You're trying to hold that football a little bit too long. When you got guys like Woodley coming after you, you better get rid of the football.
Well, we have a moment. Here's Reese Davis.
All right, Sean, Iowa and Montana, and they're celebrating in that $86 million stadium improvement by putting up some offense. Drew Tate finding the freshman Dominique Douglas for the touchdown, 17-0 Hawkeye.
And here it's 13-7 Michigan. Lloyd Carr wants another chance with the football with a minute 31 to go. And Vanderbilt looking at third down and 18 from its own 11-yard line.
Big question, though, at third and 18 in the field position. I love the use of timeouts by Lloyd Carr to create field position. Again, you give your opportunity maybe to set up a return for a dangerous return man in Stevie Breston.
We could well see the impact of the new rules here with the ball changing possession should Vanderbilt have the punt. The clock doesn't stop anymore in the change, but it does stop, but then it is wound again. So Michigan will have to move very quickly after they receive the punt, try to maximize the time while on offense. Rob?
Well, guys, there's some speculation upstairs on, you know, why is Mike Hart not out there as much? It appears he is fine. I just walked by him on the sideline. No trainers around him, nobody attending to him. Remember, they said they are very deep at tailback this year in Michigan. Looks to be just like a coach's decision. Get everybody some reps.
Third down and 18. Nixon, quarterback draw. Running room along the sideline. He tried to hurdle toward that first down marker. Didn't get there. Morgan Trent chased him out a couple of yards short of the first down. Here's Reese.
And Sean, I'm back with friends for the Pontiac Performance Halftime Report. Lou Holtz and Mark May here. We'll talk about some Big Ten tune-ups, an impressive debut thus far for the new Texas quarterback. And on that subject, guys, he's going to need to step up for teams like the Longhorns and USC.
Well, for USC, if you start as a freshman, you know, you must be good. Stay tuned at halftime. We'll tell you who and why.
For Texas, I think it's got to be the running game. That offensive line, Selvin Young, Jamal Charles, the running game has to step up for Texas.
And so far, McCoy's been good. See you at halftime, guys.
All right, we'll look forward to it. Brett Upson with a very good punt, driving Breston back to the 28. And it's well covered as well by Vanderbilt. 46-yard punt, D.J. Moore right there to take down Breston. We'll see how Michigan plays it. Two timeouts left, a minute 14 left in the half. Monday night, ESPN Full Circle, presented by the Dish Network, brings you every angle of the Florida State-Miami game. ESPN with the full broadcast of the game. ESPN2 with close-ups. ESPNU and 360 with Skycam and commentary from Colin Cowherd. That's Monday night, 8 Eastern time.
Just checking how the new rule would affect Michigan. They called the play on the sidelines and are huddled on the sidelines.
They did run the clock a little bit before Michigan got over the ball on that change of possession. Low throw by Henny. Intended for Steve Breston. You saw that Mike Hart is back in the game, so apparently he is physically fine. Henny now 7 out of 13 passing for 83 yards.
And that was the same play where they cleared out and brought Breston underneath the cross middle where they converted a key third down. Vanderbilt was ready.
Michigan dominating statistically, but leading by 6 points. Drop passes, a blocked field goal, a key. Mike Hart bounced down by Marcus Buggs near the first down marker at the 37-yard line. It is a first down. Says Bill Lamagne. Bobby Johnson not quite sure that it's a first down. He's saying, wait a minute, how can you call that a first down? Bill Lamagne signaled first down, but the chains didn't move. And now there are flags and the officials are conferring.
All start, 54, offense. 5-yard penalty, still first down.
Well, we just had a little bit of confusion on Michigan's sidelines. You're looking at Chad Henney, he wants to call timeout. The coaches are waving him off. Then you get the confusion by the center who false starts. That's tough to do if you're the center because you're supposed to be the guy that throws the ball back there.
Well, there's confusion about what down it is. It says first down on the down marker, but the chains never moved. And before that ball was snapped and there was the penalty, that down marker said third down. Even though Bill Lamagne, the referee, had signaled first down, and I think very prematurely, because if it was a first down, it was very close and needed to be measured.
The chains had not caught up after the previous play. It was first and 10. Then we had the false start by the offense. We have first and 15. First and 15. Clock will start on the ready for play.
And I don't blame Bobby Johnson. Bill Lamagne signaled first down when there was plenty of question of whether or not the ball had moved past the marker. Lloyd Carr's mad too. But the referee, Bill Lamagne, in my opinion, messed this up when he signaled first down, because there was plenty of question about whether or not it was. And you could tell by the reaction of the other officials and the fact that the chain gang never moved that there was plenty of question about whether or not it was a first down. And you now know, both coaches are mad.
I've never seen where both coaches aren't happy with the call. And right there you have Lloyd and Bobby both very upset with the call. And maybe the chain gang, it's their first game too, an official's first game, but you have the chain gang and the officials got to be working together. First down, move the chains.
Well, Bill Lamagne signaled first down, but I'm not sure the other official saw it or the chain gang saw it. And I think the reason why perhaps they didn't see it, A, he was in a bit of a crowd when he did it, and B, there was plenty of question about whether or not it was a first down. As a matter of fact, you can tell Bobby Johnson doesn't think it was a first down. And from here, I think he's probably right. It didn't even look like it was a first down, but for some reason, the referee went ahead and signaled that it was. Well, let's go back to two plays ago and the run by Hart. He gets tackled. There's the yellow line. Appears to be down short. The ball's not on that yellow line.
Again, it depends on where the official, the ball might not be on there, but it's where the mark of the ball right by the official.
But certainly close enough, you would think.
A measurement.
You need a measurement. Yes. But Bill Lamagne never even walked up to the side of the ball. He just signaled first down. Then Mark Beal called for the penalty, the first against Michigan. So it's first and 15, and Henny throws incomplete for Hart. He had Chris Booker right in his lap.
Well, this is a problem for Michigan now. When you're able to rush three and get pressure on Chad Henny, that presents a big issue for you. Then you have to dump the ball to Chad Henny. You got to be able to pass protect five against three, something Michigan didn't do, at least that particular play.
Second and 15. Two timeouts left for each team. 13 to 7. Michigan leading in the final seconds of the half. Not being penalized throughout the half.
Change of voice inflection by Chad Henne when he audibilized. Pulled Big Mitchell off. He got excited. He wanted to get going. Chad went the audible. His voice went high. Mitchell jumped.
Alex Mitchell, the only new starter on that offensive line. Junior from Reese, Michigan. Beat out Justin Schifano in the preseason. They get the call at right guard. Couple of penalties for movement against the offensive line. Hart, the ball carrier. You get tangled up with Jonathan Goff. The crowd starts to groan. They don't like the conservative play call.
Well, you know, if I'm Bobby Johnson, I'm thinking about stopping this clock a little bit. Third and 14. I know that's crazy, but since it's third and 15, you might want to set up an opportunity to block the punt.
I think the way he's been outplayed in this half, he's very happy.
Yes.
Down by six.
Just an option, Sean. Just
yes,
an option.
And a good one, perhaps.
Not.
But I'm with Coach Johnson on this one. Get in the locker room. Be thankful it's only 13-7.
Big House faithful doesn't seem too pleased. Smattering of applause.
Well, it started out like it might be a huge day for Michigan. A very impressive opening drive. But a lot of mistakes since then. Drop passes, a blocked field goal, and on this last possession, a couple of penalties. And Mike Hart and company head up that long runway to the locker room, leading just by 13-7, despite the fact they had 236 yards to 88 for Vandy. Here's Rob Stone.
Coach, a fantastic start for your offense. After that, some issues.
I wouldn't say that.
how would you describe it?
And you take sacks, and just we've stopped ourselves. We've done some good things, but we've certainly got a lot of things we've got to get to do better.
What do you tell your offense in the locker room?
Hang on to the football, protect the quarterback.
Thanks, Coach.
I think Rob meant fantastic start on the first drive, but Lloyd chose to be a contrarian. 13-7 halftime, Michigan leading Vanderbilt.
It was a 10-play, 81.
And welcome back to Michigan Stadium. We're at halftime. The team's just now coming back onto the field to get ready for the start of the third quarter. Michigan leads Vanderbilt 13-7 as our coverage of college football presented by Cars.com continues. And welcome back to the Big House. Sean McDonough with Chris Spielman. Delighted to have you with us. The way the game started, Michigan took the opening kickoff, went 81 yards in 10 plays, a very impressive drive. Looked like they might run Vanderbilt right out of the Big House, but it didn't turn out that way.
Well, it's exactly what you wanted if you're Michigan to start the season like that. You had Brest involved, you have Hart involved, you have Henne involved making plays. But more than the plays that they made, it's the plays that Michigan didn't make in the first half that's allowing Vanderbilt to stick around.
Lloyd Carr referenced the mistakes on his way off the field. They had an early 10-0 lead and a chance to widen it. With a couple of missed opportunities in the passing game, particularly with drop balls, a big problem. They also had a field goal block late in the half. It was the Michigan defense that really started to put the heat on Chris Nixon.
Well, Chris Nixon had a couple very effective drives early on in the ball game, and they got a little bit away from their game plan. One of the things that Vandy likes to do is get rid of the ball in a hurry. And if you try to hold the ball too long and get this Michigan defense, you're going to be in trouble and take sacks.
Let's check in with Rob Stone.
Well, Sean, just got done speaking with Vanderbilt head coach Bobby Johnson. I asked him, what did he tell his new quarterback, Chris Nixon, in the locker room? He said, hey, I told him he's doing fine, but look for this. Some quicker drops, some shorter passes. Stopping Michigan's run game was a big concern of theirs. He said, hey, we need to tackle better, but we've been in good position. Lastly, I said, what was the theme in the locker room? Coach looked me in the eye and said, pressure is on them. Now we execute, we got a chance to whip them. Direct quote, Sean.
And I think he's right. Michigan, as we noted a couple times in the half, certainly had a big edge in play. The stats demonstrate that point, that they're ahead by only 6 points despite a 2-1 margin in plays run, and much better than that in total yardage and first downs.
They dominated on the ground, but again, missed opportunities. And it's interesting hearing Rob's report on Bobby Johnson and what he said. When he's quicker drops, shorter passes. That eliminates any pass rush. And being on the defensive side of the ball, I understand that that can get frustrating because all you're doing is chasing the ball. Now, it might take you a while to score points, but at least you're frustrating the defense and giving your young quarterback an opportunity to succeed.
Bobby Johnson in his fifth year at Vanderbilt. 5-6 last year. They won exactly two games in each of his first 3 years, but you could see the progress being made. Two seasons ago, they had five losses by a total of 15 points and some near misses last year. They had the big win at the end of the year at Tennessee, an early season win at Arkansas. They won at Wake Forest, but they also had the ball game against Florida that got away. They lost to Middle Tennessee State at home after they had opened 4-0. So he said, yes, we made progress. We're largely happy with the way last year went, but there's still that gnawing feeling that they could have had a winning season and could have gone to a bowl game for the first time since 1982.
Yeah, and they have their opportunity this year, but another sign of making progress, Sean, is the depth that you acquire. And they have some depth on the defensive line. A guy that's not listed as a starter has come in and been an impact player for Vanderbilt, number 90, Broderick Stewart, at defensive end. Again, if you have depth, you can roll defensive linemen in and out of there. Fresh bodies.
Vanderbilt will get the football first here in the second half. Ross Ryan kicks off. Taken by Alex Washington. And he gets popped down at the 30-yard line. Tackled by Stevie Brown. A 20-yard return by Washington.
Alex Washington forgot his blockers. See, you, when you catch that ball as a return guy, you got to say go. Alex didn't say go. He outran his blockers. That was a great return for 1-on-11.
There's Chris Nixon. Five out of eight for 37 yards passing. Sacked twice. The Michigan pressure, particularly from Lamar Woodley, was a problem late in the first half, and that ball nearly intercepted by Prescott Burgess. Pass in the flat, looking for the fullback, Stephen Bright. Burgess saw it coming and nearly picked it off.
Well, you can count that as a great play by Burgess or a missed opportunity by Burgess. Prescott's a senior. He's been around for a while, a veteran player. Again, opportunities for Michigan to make big plays. They're just making good plays instead of the great play right now.
Burgess was a starter last year. He's basically an all-around reserve. He'll play all three linebacker spots. Essentially, they have a four-man rotation at linebacker. Burgess off the bench, but plays a lot. Nixon, quarterback draw, gets a good block. Nixon out near a first down. Leon Hall made the tackle. Kaysen Jackson Garrison with a good block.
Yes, sir.
9 yard gain. Here's Rob Stone.
Well, Sean Garrison with that block. He's also playing a little banged up right now. You mentioned about that emergency appendectomy a few weeks ago. I just noticed that they put on a pad that is connected to his shoulder pads on his left arm. A deep contusion kind of between the bicep and the shoulder area. Something to keep an eye on as far as maybe how good his mobility is with that on now.
Third down and one, and Jackson Garrison doesn't get there. Rondell Biggs leading that penetration by the Michigan defense.
Penetration kills everything, especially when you start pulling people and trying to follow guards through holes. If you get penetration, you're in trouble. You'll see big 91 Rondell Biggs shoot through the line of scrimmage, lining up. Right there, penetration does a good job of beating the blocker inside. Penetration will kill any type of pulling movement on the offensive line.
Steve Breston hasn't been able to shake free yet in the return game. He's dangerous every time. Brett Upson's punt short. Didn't get all the way back to Breston. And down at the 26-yard line by DJ Moore. 38-yard punt. We're going to spot it at the 27 where it was first touched. College football from the Big House. Michigan jumped out to an easy 7-0 lead after their opening drive. It looked like it might be a cakewalk, but certainly it has not turned out to be that way. First and 10 Michigan, first possession of the second half for the Wolverines. And Mike Hart weaved through the traffic out to the 33-yard line, tackled by Theo Horrocks. Mike is approaching 100 yards rushing for the day, and that's been a great barometer for Michigan and Hart's career. The Wolverines 9-1 when he rushes for 100 or more. The only loss was last year against Minnesota.
If I had one criticism of Mike Hart, it's tough to criticize a guy that has 98 yards. Maybe a little bit less dancing and a little bit more straight line running. And he's a powerful runner for his size.
Michigan burns a timeout. And it's second play from scrimmage in the second half. About 107,000 in the big house, but very quiet right now. That terrific start for Michigan. Mediocre performance since then. You have to think some of these fans are wondering, is it shades of last year all over again?
A fair question to ask. And again, it's not been so much a lack of execution, but a lack of jumping up and making a play when the opportunity has been there.
After the Michigan timeout, they hand it off to Breston. And Jonathan Goff took him out of bounds at the 46-yard line. Good call by Mike DeBoard, well executed for a 13-yard gain.
Anytime you're able to run the ball right up the gut like Michigan's been able to do most of the day, and you put this in the game plan, and you have a threat like Stevie Breston, absolutely it's a weapon. It's a good job by Jonathan Goff, the top defensive player for the Vandies, coming over and making a playoff pursuit.
Nick DeBoard, offensive coordinator. When they won in 1997, they won the national title. Here's Hart across midfield, run down again by Goff from behind. Mike DeBoard left to become the head coach at Central Michigan. Resigned, came back here. Coached special teams for a couple of years. He said he really enjoyed that. So when you coach special teams, you're working with players from offense and defense. You get to know a lot about a lot of the young men on the football team. When you're coaching the offense, generally you're around the offense.
You've got to be practical with your time. You got a lot to get through with limited amount of time with meetings and practice. Got to be organized and ready to go and have everybody's attention and have effective special teams.
That 7-yard gain by Hart got him over 100 to 105. That magical number. Flag down as Hart gets the first down yardage, but will the play stand? The referee, Bill Lamagne, threw the flag. Holding against Michigan.
Maybe one of the reasons why Vandy's front four aren't getting off the blocks like they should. Very impressed with
Handling.
Michigan's offensive line.
72 offense, 10 yards previous spot, still second down.
Reuben Riley had a hold of Chris Booker. Here's Rob Stone.
Well, Sean, Chris just said the front four not getting off the blocks. The linebackers playing a little thin right now for Vanderbilt. Starting strong side linebacker Marcus Buggs. They spent the last couple minutes doing some kind of creative stretches with him on the sideline. They finally have just taken him up to the locker room. They are saying he is cramping in the quad. He's up there getting some IVs. Hope they can be back. They think and believe he will be.
And they're depleted coming in at linebacker. Two backup linebackers, Brandon Bryant and Quavion Lewis, serving one game suspension, sitting out this game for a violation of team rules. Henny got away and turned it into a gain. Fontaine Hunter, one of those backup linebackers, came on a blitz and whiffed on Henny. Greg Billinger made the tackle. A 6-yard gain.
It's a good job by Fontaine Hunter. Comes on blocked again. A blown opportunity by Michigan to get rid of the ball, but an opportunity to make a play. When you have your quarterback in your sights, Jen Henney's a big strapping guy. You don't need to kill shot. Just make a tackle. Wrap him up, throw him down. You're a linebacker. He's a quarterback. You can do it.
Third down and 8 for Michigan. And movement. Greg Matthews, freshman, Carl Tabb. Senior wide receiver.
Still third down.
A lot of miscommunication, Sean, with the pass protection for Michigan. They They've been having some big powwows down there on the bench with the offensive line. They're still having a little bit of trouble picking up the zone pressures that Vanderbilt's throwing at them.
10 minutes to go, third quarter. Michigan leading 13-7. Third down and long, Henny with a lot of time, running out of time. He's going to try to run for it, and he will not get there. Tackled at the Vanderbilt 49 by Jonathan Goff, who seems to be making the tackle on every play. 8 yards for Henny, but he's about four, almost 5 yards short of the first down. So Michigan sends Zoltan Mesko on to punt.
Now, if you're Vanderbilt, you have your ears up here. This is primary fake territory. Be careful of not jumping early either. A lot of times they'll have a trick little snap count for you. Inside 5 yards to go on fourth down.
Mesko does punt it. It's short. Again, takes a good roll for Zoltan. His parents hail from Romania. Down to the 13-yard line. 35-yard punt. Back at Michigan Stadium, Sean McDonough, Chris Spielman, and Rob Stone. 9 minutes to go. Third quarter, Vanderbilt first and 10 from their own 13-yard line, trailing 13-7. Nixon tried to draw, and Michigan was not fooled. All of a sudden, Nixon has plenty of company in blue shirts in the backfield, play after play. This time it was Rondell Biggs, the senior from Southfield, Michigan.
And set up by Sean Crable, had an opportunity to get his sack. But what they're doing is they're blitzing everybody, and they're not honoring any run. There's Sean Crable on a little in stunt, two guys going outside. He comes up the middle. But they're not honoring any run game whatsoever. What allows them to do is put their ears back and come for blood. Sharks to blood, baby. Go get the quarterback.
Difficulty rushing the ball. Nixon lost five off his total on the last play. Jason Jackson Garrison has rushed five times for minus three. Nixon wrapped up by Sean Crable. Then we check in again with Reese Davis.
All right, Sean, Virginia Tech opening the season against Northeastern. The new Tech quarterback is Sean Glennon, and he cuts his arm loose, finding Josh Morgan running wide open behind the Northeastern secondary. Okie, hokey, hokey high up in the first quarter, 20-0 already.
Well, putting it on my Huskies of Northeastern University. A lot of McDonoughs are Northeastern graduates. It'll be a sad day in the family. Third down and 15. Play clock down to two as Nixon takes the snap. The inside hand off to Kason Jackson Garrison. He's out to the 13-yard line. Rob Stone said he made a remarkable recovery from the appendectomy. We're told that the surgeon who did it, Chris, is a Michigan State graduate, Dr. Mike Holtzman, and he was determined to get Jackson Garrison back on his feet quickly so he could play against Michigan State's big rival, these Wolverines.
College football does live here, and it touches all of our lives, even if you're a doctor in Tennessee operating. Bitter rivalry between Michigan State and Michigan.
Upson punting from the end zone. Low snap, and he fielded it. Not a great kick. He hopes for a good bounce and gets it. Preston sees room, so he fielded the ball and returned it to the 41. The sun may be setting on summer, but the Los Angeles Angels of Anaheim are hoping to heat up. Behind the big bat of Vladimir Guerrero, the Angels are looking to gain ground to the American League West when they visit beautiful Comerica Park. Hands-on manager Jim Leland and his back-to-basics approach still has the Tigers on top of the American League Central. The Angels visit Detroit on Sunday Night Baseball. Well, we're about a 40-minute drive from Comerica Park. These sports fans in this part of the country are very excited about the Tigers, although they had a bit of a wobbly August. They're hoping that he'll remain one of the great stories in baseball this season with a strong September. Mike Hart, the ball carrier, tackled at the 35 by Theo Horrocks. The statistical domination continues, but it's still a precarious 6-point lead with 6 minutes to go in the third quarter. right hard again. Down about a yard short of the first down, tackled by Chris Booker.
Curtis Gatewood.
We're talking about any changes philosophically that Michigan's offense brings this year. Again, it's the implementation of the zone running game. And the basic philosophy behind zone blocking and zone running is you want to get the ball deep to the tailback, and he has option to run any hole between tackle to tackle. And they've done a pretty good job executing, as witnessed by the yards gained on the ground for Michigan.
The board talked about simplifying things a little bit. They'd like to run the same play with greater regularity, just run it out of different looks. Repetition is a good thing. Hart carries for the first down. Last year, I watched Michigan's game, broadcast the game against Wisconsin. It looked like they were all over the map offensively. We never really could settle on what they wanted to be as a unit. That's really not typical Michigan offense. It looks like they're going back to what made them the Michigan Wolverines.
Well, you look at their strength. Obviously, you have Breston and Manningham at receivers, but their more of a strength is that offensive line and depth at running back, including number 20, Michael Hart.
And he might be changing the play. He likes some of the changes. Said last year he had a number of plays, but the formation was a run every time, and the opponent started to know it after a while. His pass dropped by Carson Butler. A backup tight end. At least four drops today by Michigan receivers. Certainly not helping Chad Henne.
Chad Henne again is suffering. Rashard Lankford's coming with pressure, and Chad Henne again throws a beautiful ball low and away where only his man can get it. As you mentioned, Sean, blown opportunities. You know what? Come playing time, coach is going to look at it. Hey, we got to go with guys who are going to catch the ball.
Second and 10, Hart. Again, tackled by Jonathan Goff. Well, Mel Kiper Jr. has Jonathan Goff ranked as the number one junior linebacker in the country. And with this performance today, you can understand why Mel is so high on Goff. Goff said when his position coach told him that, he was very excited and flattered that Mel thinks so highly of him.
Fine young man, engineering student. Knows all the angles, I guess. But right there, Lankford had a shot to hit Michael Hart in the hole. Michael Hart gives him a little shimmy, shammy shake. Misses, and that's, you know, the scheme is all right for Vanderbilt. It's just about making tackles. If you're the on-block player, come up and make a hit.
Hart breaking tackles, but not enough to get to the first down marker, it appears. And the crowd wants Lloyd Carr to go for it on fourth down. Looks like it's going to be fourth and less than a yard.
There's your opportunity. You want to establish some toughness and some belief in your offense, you go for it. Or if you want a two-possession ball game, the kicker away. I like the call here of going for it. Give your confidence offense, and you're telling them right now, Sean, that I believe in what you guys are doing, and I know you can win the battle up front. Little play action
ahead by two scores.
Little play action.
Kicker. And a chance to take a 9-point lead. Brady, as I said, go for it. Jonathan Goff the tackle, but it was too late to stop Brady. A bigger back than Hart, not as big as he was a year ago, in much better shape. Devin Grady, the all-time leading rusher in the history of Michigan high school football, with 8,431 yards at East Grand Rapids.
Look at the get off by the Michigan line. When you're able to get your pad level, Alex Mitchell gets his pad level lower than his guys, you change the line of scrimmage. That was a great call because he believes in his offensive line. Guess what? The offensive line answered the challenge for Coach Carr.
And the drive continues. First and 10 at the 16-yard line. Henne play action pass. He was under pressure, and his throw went through the hands of Mike Massey, the junior from Rexville, Ohio.
And one of the biggest, and I might be alone in my theory, but one of the biggest misconceptions that people talk about is how play action is set up by the run. If you're a veteran team, play action pass should never be a problem because the blocking scheme up front is different. And guess what? If you're a smart lineman or defense, you can hear play action. On run, there's big grunts and sounds coming out of those O-line. On pass, you hear nothing.
Reverse, Mario Manningham. And well defended by Vanderbilt. Chased out just inside the 14-yard line. Ben Koger, fifth-year senior safety, a backup. Coaches talk about his intelligence and ability to play good assignment football, and there was evidence of that right there, just a 2-yard gain.
It's good effort, Rasute. See, Mario Manningham, Stevie Breston, hands inside. You'll never get called for holding if your hands are inside the defenders. Once they call holding, hands go outside and you give them a hug.
Here's Koger, 10th play of the drive now for Michigan from the 14, third down and 8. Penny back in the end zone, caught! Touchdown, Tyler Ecker, the tight end. On a day of a lot of drop balls by the Wolverines, a magnificent catch and a 14-yard touchdown.
When you're 6'6", you're a target, and a big target. Watch Chad Henne right here. He knows where he's going. He's going to that 6'6 tight end down the middle of the seam. Linebacker beats a linebacker on coverage. Kevin Joyce. Kevin Joyce looked back for the ball. Number one rule, you go up and play the hands, don't play the ball. Man to man, go get it.
The extra play. Looked like it was deflected, but it got through anyway. It is good for Garrett Rivas. Tyler Ecker on the preseason watch list for the John Mackey Award, which goes to the best tight end in the country. Nice leaping catch in the back of the end zone.
Up there you see Kevin Joyce. When you have a tight end that's bigger than you, you do not look back for the football. Chad Henne understands the height advantage that Tyler has over Kevin Joyce and puts it up high. If Kevin Joyce would have kept his eyes on the receiver, Sean, he can go up and play the hands. Finally, Henne says, thank you for making a play for me. Said, stick with me, Chad. I'll make you a star.
First touchdown reception of the year for Ecker. He had 4 last year. 49th career touchdown pass for Henne. He's up to 3rd all time now at the University of Michigan, and he's thrown at least one touchdown pass in 24 of his 25 career games. Only Minnesota prevented him from throwing a touchdown pass last year when the Gophers beat the Wolverines.
I wonder if Chad's going to take Tyler to one of those tattoo parties as a reward. A great play, great catch, a lot of composure.
Ross Ryan will kick off. Alex Washington from the 1. And he got walloped at the 19-yard line. Anton Campbell again, a standout on kickoff coverage. An 18-yard return. Here's Reese.
All right, Sean, the co-national black college champions from last year, Grambling and Hampton, meeting in the MEAC SWAC Challenge. And Brandon Landers of Grambling finding Henry Tolbert. Landers, the guy stepping in for big Bruce Eugene, who quarterbacked there last year. Grambling up 20-10 on ESPN2.
And here it's Chris Nixon and Vanderbilt. They see a 13-point deficit now. The sun has broken through the clouds, a mostly cloudy day. They thought they might get some rain here today on the western fringe of Ernesto. Still a possibility later today. Nixon keeps. Tackled by Jamar Adams at the 20. The gain of only a yard. With the sun out, the wind is now gusting. The wind wasn't much of a factor earlier, but clearly it has picked up here in the last few minutes, as you can see by that flag.
Vanderbilt trying to run a little bit of the speed option. It's tough to run if it's not a staple part of your offense out of two back set. Timing looked a little off. Michigan's defense is playing fast.
Vanderbilt hasn't been able to sustain anything all day offensively. Still just 95 total yards on offense. Rondell Biggs there to drop Kason Jackson Garrison. Another 1 yard gain as we go down to 1 minute left in the third quarter. And Ron English has to be very pleased with the performance of his defense in his first game as coordinator.
I'd be pleased, especially his run defense. Guys are getting off blocks and getting the ball, and that's the one thing he really emphasized to us in the meetings and in spring football, is 11 helmets on the ball, and guys have done that and they've kept that up.
Third down and 8. Michigan blitzes again. Nixon's pass is incomplete, looking for Earl Bennett. Jamar Adams had the coverage. The junior from Charlotte, North Carolina. The offensive woes continue. You don't know how much of it you can pin on Chris Nixon, but they did have a three-man battle to be the starting quarterback in the preseason. You wonder if they would think about changing quarterbacks.
Well, I think it's Chris Nixon that's throwing the ball. His guy's got to step up and make a play for him. He's going to his number one man in Earl Bennett. Earl Bennett dropped the football. Rule is receiver, especially of Earl's caliber, ball hits your hands, catch ball.
Brett Upson's punt short again, and Breston runs up to make a fair catch in Vandy territory at the 47-yard line. Just a 27-yard punt, but there is a flag. And they rough the kicker. You think it was Stevie Brown, the guilty party.
Personal foul, roughing the kicker. Number 30 on the defense. 15-yard penalty, previous spot. Automatic, first down.
Yeah, no doubt about that.
I think Stevie would have been better off if he didn't stick his hands out there to try to sell the fact that he was going to hold him up. Just run through it. Get on the ground. His hands came out, Sean, and that's what caused him the punter to fall. That's a freshman punter. He didn't take his acting classes down at Vanderbilt yet. He's going to stay up.
Lloyd Carr, thinking his team was poised to perhaps put the game away. Well, looks at the possession, staying with Vanderbilt in the final seconds of the third quarter. And much better field position now, 36-yard line. Three wide receivers spread the formation for Nixon. Oh, boy. Marlon White this time with the case of the drops. Charles Stewart had the coverage. He won a battle in the preseason to be their starting corner opposite Leon Hall.
We've seen it from both sides, and you're having problems with fundamentals. One, or guys' heads are going off the ball before they catch a ball. And two, everybody's is cradle catching and body catching. Use those hands. You got big, strong hands as a receiver. Snag the ball, a la Chris Carter, Anthony Carter, any other Carter.
Jared Hawkins, a freshman running back in the ballgame now. Nixon faked to him. Nixon throws. Incomplete and almost intercepted. There is a flag down. Jamar Adams on the back of George Smith.
I do believe Jamar caught him with the right hand hook.
Pass interference, defense, number 22. Spot foul, automatic, first down.
Yep. Yeah.
See, he didn't have to hook him either. All he has to do is work over the top, and you'll get the benefit of the call. They'll let you play a little bit of defense, but as soon as that hand comes on, that's the hook. Referee puts his hook in his pocket and throws the flag.
Kelly against Adams, who started the last six games of last season, brings the ball up to the 49-yard line. They stay in the shotgun. Look out. Nixon running for his life, throws it up for grabs and away over the head of Earl Bennett. Nixon lost a tire. Sean Crable was in pursuit. Somebody lost it. Not sure. No, it wasn't Nixon. It was Eugene Germany.
One of the luxuries Ron English, the defensive coordinator, Lloyd Carr, have is they're able to shuttle in eight or nine guys playing on the defensive line. Anytime you get fresh bodies rolling on the same five guys as the offensive line, it gets to be a challenge, especially when you know you have to throw the ball and you can't run it because all the D-line doing, putting your ears back and coming.
Likely to be the final play of the third quarter. Second and 10, Vanderbilt. Pitched back to Jared Hawkins, the freshman who's had an impressive camp. He lowered his shoulder and got to the 44-yard line. It'll be third down when the fourth quarter begins. Start of the fourth quarter, Michigan leading 20-7. Sean McDonough with Chris Spielman and Rob Stone. Big play to open the fourth quarter for Vanderbilt. Third down and three, perhaps in four down territory, just inside the Michigan 45. Out of the shotgun, Chris Nixon drops it off over the middle, incomplete, behind Stephen Bright, the former quarterback. He realized he wasn't going to play that position when Jay Cutler was on the same team. Moved the fullback and has made a nice transition. He's a good player. That wasn't a very good throw.
Not a bad call. What they did was Stephen Bright kind of just bumped Sean Crable, then had a delayed route. Was able to execute again. That's blown opportunities for Vanderbilt. They haven't had that kind of field position all day. Take advantage. They didn't.
Brett Upson. Steve Breston back at his 10-yard line. Upson hits it straight up. And it goes out of bounds at the 18-yard line, a 26-yard punt. Vanderbilt can't get anything going on the ground. They've rushed for 36 yards. The run defense has been stout. And the pass defense hasn't been all that bad either. Nixon under duress, particularly from the middle of the second quarter on. The only score of this second half on the touchdown pass, Henny to Eckert. ...318 yards. Total offense for Michigan, just 103 for Vandy. Mike Hart on first and 10. 4-yard gain to the 22. Here's Reese.
All right, this is not going to lessen John L. Smith's need for asbestos underwear. Michigan State and Idaho. Jason Bird right through the gate, and Idaho's in there 17-10. Sparty hanging on. A lot of time left in the fourth.
Not too far up the road from here in East Lansing. Spartans and Wolverines will renew their rivalry in early October here in Ann Arbor. On October 7th, Henny looked one way, then the throwback is low and incomplete. Bounced into Carson Butler.
It's a first bad pass, really, that Chad Henny has thrown.
The backup quarterbacks, that's Mackenzie Adams, number 9, nearest the camera, and Richard Kovalchuk, are throwing. They've been throwing a couple of times earlier today as well, with no sign of actually entering the ball game.
Kovalchuk's a transfer from Arizona that actually has big time game experience.
Started 8 games at Arizona over a couple of seasons. And a flush. And he's running, and he gets banged out of bounds at the 25-yard line, short of the first down. That man again, Jonathan Goff from Lynn, Massachusetts. It's unusual to have a player from Massachusetts down at Vanderbilt. He said when he visited the Vandy campus, it reminded him of his high school, St. John's Prep in Danvers, Mass. He liked the fact that it was a great academic school. He's always been academically inclined, mechanical engineering major. And he welcome the opportunity to play SEC football. Raised by his mom, who's a judge in the juvenile court system in the Boston area. Lauren Speed is the injured player, freshman from Georgia.
Sean, you and I were talking, you've done Vanderbilt games in the past, and you described them as pesky, and I think that's an accurate description. They've been pesky today. Really, if they can get any offense, and the key to their offense is they got to start winning some first downs, so they're not playing behind the sticks every time they have the ball on second or third down. It opens up some more options that they can do on their offense, but if they're third and 15, it's over because of the pass rush that the Wolves are bringing.
Well, they're well coached. The talent level is improving. It certainly isn't up to the level of a Michigan yet, but they're becoming more and more competitive athletically. As Bobby Johnson said, we're in their fifth year now, so everybody in the program are players that they've coached, and a lot of these guys have been in these systems for a while, which also helps. Harold Bennett looked like he collided with one of his own teammates when he went to field the punt. It gets touched by Michigan near the 38-yard line. 37-yard punt for Zoltan Mesko.
We've been.
This college football kickoff weekend continues here on ESPN before 109,668 fans. 194th straight home game with more than 100,000 on hand here at Michigan Stadium. Earl Bennett takes the quick pass and leaps across the 50 to the 49-yard line. The last punt, by the way, was by Ross Ryan after the first two were from Zoltan Mesko. They're still trying to figure out who the punter will be, and each punter getting a chance today for Michigan. Bennett lost a shoe, so he'll go off after being tackled by Charles Stewart, a 13-yard gain.
When they had a gain on that in the first play of the game, they had a touchdown off of that look on the second play, and they get another 13-yard gain here. It's all set up by the quick passing game and a win on first down.
You said they need to do better on first down. They did there. Jared Hawkins, the running back in the game. Nixon. Well, to me, Chris, that one's on him. He had some people open and just held on too long. Tim Jamison took him down. Here's Reese Davis.
All right, Sean, elsewhere in the Big Ten, Iowa continuing to roll over Montana. Here is Drew Tate. Iowa's going to use a lot of two tight end alignments this year, and Scott Chandler's going to catch a lot of passes. There's one for a touchdown there. 31-7 there. Look at Indiana State hanging with that much maligned Purdue defense from last year. It's only a 5-point game at the break.
Great quarterbacks in the Big Ten this year, Sean. 9 returning starters.
Pitch to Hawkins after Nixon got leveled by Sean Crable. Nixon paid the price, but it turned out to be a good gainer for Vanderbilt down to the 41-yard line. 2 yards short of the first down, Jamar Adams took down Hawkins.
Well, he had a speed option. That means no lead blocker. He has to read the end, and Crable reads, does a good job. He takes a shot. Hawkins running the option perfectly. I'll tell you, if I'm Michigan now, what I do is I change my tactic up on option football. I don't come in and take the quarterback out. I kind of feather that quarterback and mirror him, make him make a decision, which allows the pursuit of the other winged helmets to come and help me.
Nixon on 3rd and 2 throws for a first down to the 32-yard line. Caught in traffic by George Smith. Charles Stewart, the tackle, 9-yard gain, and a first down for Vanderbilt.
Great read by Chris Nixon. What they did, one guy goes out short. If you're a Michigan guy, you got to think somebody behind. George Smith does a good job finding the open in the zone coverage. Again, though, guys are body catching the football, and he almost let that one slip through. Snag it with your hands. I'm going to say it all year until I see somebody do it.
To go. Michigan leads 20-7. Nixon hangs on again way too long and gets smothered by Jamar Adams. 5th sack for Michigan.
Marlon White ran the wrong route. He's supposed to run a corner, but again, they're trying to set up the play action off the speed option look. And if you don't have it, you gotta, if you're Chris Nixon, guess what? Throw it away.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to make everything out of every play. Throw it away, live to fight the next down. It should be 2nd and 10 as opposed to 2nd and eternity.
You can see those blue shirts coming. Did not throw it away, lost 9. Back to the 42. And now some confusion. The team's trying to get this play communicated. Yep. On the 42-yard line, and that's a drop. Very nearly a lateral to George Smith. Boy, it's an epidemic on both sides today. Drop passes.
Now, a la Rich Rodriguez down in West Virginia, Vanderbilt is now calling plays from the sideline in the line of scrimmage. They're getting lined up, and they'll look it to the coaching staff to the side to see if they run it or if he wants to change it. Now they're in the huddle, but they've done that the last series just to kind of give Chris Nixon some help and put him in the best possible play to succeed.
Offensive coordinator Ted Kane needs to come up with something special here. 3rd down and 19. Only a 4-man rush that time. The ball is caught by Earl Bennett, short of a first down. Did Charles Stewart draped all over him and still managed to catch the ball at the 26. And now a decision for Bobby Johnson.
Well, I think you go for it, absolutely. You don't get down in this territory very often. No. Fourth quarter, time's running. You do have the passing game working a little bit, but you see the effects of the sack that Chris Nixon took.
Yep,
Sean.
They're in field goal range, but that wouldn't do them a heck of a lot of good right now. Still be down by 10 with about 9 minutes to go should Honfeld connect. So they'll go for it on fourth and five. Four receivers and Hawkins the running back. A low snap handled by Nixon. Nobody open. Has to throw it up. Just heaves it toward the corner of the end zone. Incomplete. Intended for Earl Bennett. Charles Stewart had coverage. Nixon was out of time, had to throw it someplace, hoping Bennett could rescue it, but no chance for Earl.
ESPN's College Football is presented by Cars.com. Find the right car for you. Cars.com. And in part by Cooper Tires. Don't give up a thing.
Michigan has won its last 12 home season openers. Trying to make it 13 in a row against this pesky Vanderbilt squad out of Nashville, Tennessee. 20-7. Michigan has the lead. Under 9 minutes to go in the fourth quarter. Mike Hart on first down, tried to turn the corner and got a yard. Out to the 28. Jonathan Goff there again, his 14th tackle of the ball game. Sean McDonough and Chris Spielman, big story of the game. We thought coming in, missed tackles, usually the first game problem. Today it's been drop balls.
Well, it's drop balls because everybody's trying to body catch. Everybody's catching the ball underhand like this. And you know what? I got young kids. I coach youth football, and I know I'm not a brilliant guy, but I know this.
Yes,
if you take a football and you start firing that ball at the kids' heads and their faces, their hands come up, and they learn to catch the ball with their hands. It's irritating.
That was
brilliant. I'm getting there. I'm all right.
That was brilliant. Mike Hart. Breaks free from an ankle tackle. You can see the frustration in Chris Booker as he slammed the turf. Had a chance at Hart a couple of yards earlier. Bennett has it go through his arms. Yeah. I think he would have been out of bounds anyway, but still, catch it.
But that's the point that's happened throughout the whole game twice with Earl Bennett. His hands are turned upside down. If you go up and snag the ball with your hands, fingers facing to the sky and thumbs to the sky, you got a chance. But anytime you try to underhand it or body catch it, it's a chance for error increases. Michael Hart, I'll tell you what he's done this second half. He cut all the juking and jiving, and he's going straight ahead. That's the Michael Hart I know.
Here he comes again. 26th carry of the day. Theo Horrocks makes the tackle. Let's check in with Reese Davis.
All right, Sean, let's check in now on Idaho and Michigan State.
Stanton
against Bruce Stanton, only with a touchdown lead, buys himself a little time and end up dumping this thing to Javon Ringer. That sets up J.U. Colquitt touchdown, and Idaho's threatening again. 24-10, 10 minutes left in the fourth.
Here at 7 minutes left in the fourth. First down Michigan from their own 40. Hart up to 144 yards rushing. He shoved out of bounds for a loss there. Ooh, the official got upended. Curtis Gatewood made the stop on Hart. And good to see the official back on his feet.
The headlinesman, he took the chain guy out too. Chain guy's got to drop sticks, man.
Could you say it was a chain reaction?
Yeah. Oh, he just got clipped. You got to keep your feet, play off the low block. Use your hands, official man. Use your hands, protect your knees. You got cut blocked, leg whipped. Yeah. Come on, shake it off, take a tough pill. He is, he's a Big Ten official.
He'll be all right. No Dave Perry, rooting for his guys. Dave does a great job, supervisor.
Ooh, nice. Get up now, don't lay on the ground, don't let them know you're hurt.
Attaboy.
I'm sorry, did I say that out loud?
I'll let you know which official that is, but I believe it's Rick Krueger. Second and 11. First carry for a loss by Hart today. Manny, the short drop. And drop is the word of the day. Tyler Ecker has it flying off his hands. Hopefully Rob Stone can catch this throw to him. Stoner?
I never drop anything, Sean. You know that. Hey, this is a massive drive in Coach Carr's mind because one of his mantras in the offseason was, we need to learn to finish. And to achieve that goal, they spent a lot of time working on fitness, dropping weight, and increasing their stamina through the offseason. And that goes from the quarterback to the offensive tackle to everybody on defense. Coach Carr knows, man, these games are tight, particularly when we get to the Big Ten. Their margin of error was so slim last year. Several of their games lost by about an average of 4 points. They know if they're a little bit stronger, a little bit fresher, a little bit fleeter, that they can up that record and be a serious BCS contender. Need to learn to finish. They need to finish right now.
An illegal formation penalty that was declined by Vanderbilt. So on third and long, there's another flag down as Henny scrambles, and it's almost intercepted. Warren Speed had to go off his hands. Intended for Mario Manningham. Holding against Michigan, that will be declined, and the Wolverines will punt, and we'll see which punter comes up.
Well, Sean, again, we talk about the opportunities for Vanderbilt. Speed right there has a chance to make a big play, maybe a touchdown for Vanderbilt. And it's blown opportunities. Nobody catches the ball. I got two words, jugs machine. Everybody. Coaches included.
Zoltan Mesko back out. He had the first two punts of the day for Michigan. Ross Ryan the last one. Now Mesko again. He's averaged 40.5 yards per punt. Bennett standing back at his own 20. And we talked about what a nice leg Mesko has. He's demonstrated that a couple times today. Bennett trying to find the right path, never did. 45-yard punt by Mesko. Vanderbilt ball to 21 when we come back. .609 to go. And the clock will now run. The new rule involving change of possession. Vanderbilt runs right out over the ball. 6 minutes to go. They're down by 13, and they start this possession at their own 21. Good pass by Chris Nixon. And the catch in traffic by Earl Bennett, just shy of the first down. Here's Reese.
Had a little drama unfolding not far away from you guys in Ann Arbor in East Lansing. Michigan State up by 14 on Idaho. A fourth down play, and there's Steve Wichman to Lee Smith. It is now 24-17 in East Lansing.
Here at second and one, Chris Nixon. From Brundage, Alabama, a town of only about 2,300. He was valedictorian of his high school class at Pike County. Gave it to Kaysen Jackson Garrison, who couldn't get out of the backfield. Sean Crable, Rondell Biggs. Dropped the play for a loss. And the woes continue, particularly in the running game for Vanderbilt.
You need to evacuate the run up the middle because of the penetration and the size. See Lamar Woodley lining up here inside, something he's not used to doing. Put Sean Crable as a pass rushing linebacker outside. Now the best 11 on the field.
Taking a lot of time with under 5 minutes to go and down by 13. Where it hurts to have an inexperienced quarterback. Where it helps to have a great athlete at quarterback. Nixon fumbles again. And the Wolverines have it. Brandon Engelman knocked it out, and Leon Hall recovered. Third time today, Nixon has put it on the ground.
Well, if he's going to be a player, number one rule for all quarterbacks, protect the football. And all I see is air. And you don't protect that football if you're running quarterback. Engelman's smart. Look at him coming, strike at that football. That's it. He knows that ball's loose. See that? Excellent play by Engelman.
Wonder, though, was he down before the ball came out?
Well, I believe the ball was coming out.
They are going to review it with 4:33 to go.
You know, I know Coach Bobby Johnson and Ted Kane. If you got a running quarterback, you better learn how to hold the football. Mm-hmm. I can't think of a better example. Anybody that watches football, watch Tiki Barber hold the football. There's no air. You're going to see air in the armpit right there. See that? Bam. That's automatic. That's bait right there.
It looked like he tried to get the ball back up against his chest. Yep. After Engelman rips it here, it comes back into the chest of Nixon, but he doesn't really ever get possession of it back.
I don't think he has possession.
The call was for a fumble too. I don't see any conclusive proof to overturn that. Yeah, he never does have it back in his grasp. And it was coming out while he's still up.
It'll be interesting to go back and watch the practice tape to see if this was a habit, because that's habit forming. And Michigan's smart and well coached, that when they know they got a guy that leaves a loaf of bread out there for the eating, man, they're going to come swiping at it. Great job by Engelman. Great awareness. Nice.
Well, we were 0 for 1 already on reviews today and trying to determine how it was going to play out. See what the referee has to say this time.
The play stands as call. Fumble. First down, Michigan.
Well, we're 1 for 2 now, partner. So here comes Henny. And again, because of the change of possession, the clock will run. So if Michigan was smart here, they would take their time. And they got 20 seconds that they can still run off the clock. Staffs have spent a lot of time working on these situations, but that time Michigan, Chris, didn't pay enough attention to it. They left 20 seconds that they could have run off. Chris Booker made the tackle on Mike Hart. Here's Reese Davis.
All right, Sean, coming up just as soon as you guys are finished, top of the hour, the State Farm Classic on the LPGA Tour. Annika Sorenstam not on the leaderboard, but lurking at 7 under par. State Farm Classic coming up, top of the hour.
Of 63 today for Nancy Scranton on the LPGA Tour. Second down and 10. Again, they snapped the ball with 10 seconds on the play clock. That's Mike Hart to the 38-yard line, and now a timeout called by Vanderbilt. Gives us a chance to remind you we have more great action today here on ESPN and ESPN HD. Cal in Tennessee, followed at 8:45 Eastern by USC and Arkansas. It's all today, tonight, college football primetime on ESPN. Each team with 2 timeouts here.
There's a reason why Michael Hart's in the ballgame. Not only, obviously, he's a top running back, but he protects the football over 430 or 40 carries without a fumble. That'll get you playing time. Again, with a big question mark coming in, was would Vanderbilt be able to handle these guys? And you know, the difference between last year's Vanderbilt and this year's Vanderbilt is Vanderbilt can't get in a track meet with anybody. They got a young quarterback, and maybe later on in the year they might be able to get in that track meet. But I thought the defense, for the most part, did a pretty good job of making plays. With a little help from Michigan not making plays or capitalizing on their opportunities.
Well, obviously, Nixon's gaining experience, seems to have a lot of physical talent, but he's nowhere near Jay Cutler right now. They're determined to prove they were more than a one-man team, and they were last year, but Cutler was a big part of their success. And certainly in a situation like this in particular, you'd like to have him because he'd be much better in a hurry-up situation than Nixon at this point in his development.
Yeah, I like him, though. I think he's got a boatload of talent, and he's only going to get better and better. He throws a nice ball. He's got a little bit better decisions and protect the football.
Mike Hart, 29 rushes today. He says he's in the best shape of his life. And he's held up well in game one. Mario Manningham, a good catch on a ball a little bit behind him from Chad Henne. Josh Allen made the tackle, but that's a big conversion on 3rd down and 7 for Michigan. And the clock will run under 3.5 minutes to go after an 11-yard pickup.
You said, Sean, I tell you, it's a nice adjustment by Mario Manningham, but a lot of times quarterbacks will throw that quick slant because of coverage coming from inside. Chad Henne will throw it automatically behind because he saw speed come in and almost take a pick. That's a great throw and a great catch. Execution by Manningham.
maybe these quarterbacks just need to make the catches a little more difficult today. Seen some good catches on balls that weren't perfectly thrown. We've seen a lot of drops on balls that were well thrown. Mike Hart carries, Chris Booker the tackle. Vanderbilt elects not to use one of its two remaining timeouts here, and the clock rolls under 3 minutes.
You stop him here, obviously, take a timeout. The defense has been on the field an awful lot today for Vanderbilt. Very gutsy cliche, I know, but still a gutsy performance by the Commodore B.
And a workmanlike performance by Henny today. He will not have big numbers, but he certainly was victimized by a number of key drops. Hart swarmed under, ball out, and he was down in the arms of Kevin Joyce, and Vandy uses another timeout. 2:16 to go, one left for the Commodores. Mike Hart back healthy. Yesterday, Chad Henny talked about his backfield mate.
It's just great. I mean, having him in the huddle, just being enthusiastic, and also bringing the leadership skills that he does have, is just a great atmosphere for us. And I think with him in the backfield, we feel a lot more comfortable with pass protections and understanding that he knows the game plan and is going to bust his butt to do everything well, best he can.
He's done that through the offseason. A lot of the players talking about how he was the team leader in their offseason conditioning drills. He's one of our Cooper Tires players of the game. Hart, 146 yards rushing, and Jonathan Goff of Vanderbilt all over the field on their defense with 14 tackles, and he blocked a Garrett Rivas field goal try in the first half.
We look at Mike Hart and talking to Lloyd Carr out of the Big Ten meetings when Lloyd addressed the media. The excitement in Coach Carr's voice about having Michael Hart back was apparent. He knows what he means to his football team. Not only the physical skills that he brings to the field, but also his attitude and his fight and his drive and his desire. Something that maybe missed last year when Michael Hart got hurt.
Hart so dedicated to his conditioning in the offseason. He said that every now and then over the summer the teammates would get together and play cards. He said instead of betting money, they bet push-ups. You lost, you got down and did push-ups.
Might throw that on the kids too. Yeah. I like that.
He said, plus we don't have any money to lose anyway. We're all broke, so that became the standard of competition. Henny in the end zone. Touchdown, Mario Manningham.
It. Set him up, set him up. The old hook and go. Chad Henne throws to the back pylon. We're 8-6. Is ready for six.
27-yard touchdown pass. Jared Rivas hooks through the extra point out of Ross Ryan's hold.
See Sean Dixon up there getting a little beat. He's looking for help over the top from the safety. The problem is Mario Manningham's route was run outside, so you're not going to get inside help from your safety if you let that receiver beat you outside. Soon as Henny saw that Manningham's running outside, just let me go ahead and throw it to that back pylon and go get it, Mario. Super Mario.
Second touchdown pass of the day for Chad Henny, 50th of his career. He's on pace to become their all-time leader in passing touchdowns and passing yardage. Start of the day tied with Rick Leach, now behind John Navarre and Elvis Gerbach.
Rick Leach used to get excited wearing that number 7. Yep. After touchdown passes to left-hander. Third baseman for the Blue Jays, is that right?
Outfielder.
Yeah. Same thing, isn't it?
Yeah. We're both out there in the field somewhere. Ross Ryan kicks off. Alex Washington won't run it back. Takes a knee, 2:06 to go. Here's Reese.
All right, Sean, things going as scripted for several teams ranked in the top 25, including Virginia Tech, number 17 against Northeastern. Sean Glennon drops it off to Brandon Orr. And Brandon Orr, spent a little time away from campus in the offseason to rehab a shoulder and perhaps some say an attitude. Attitude looks just fine. Virginia Tech up 28-0 at the half. Texas rolling behind a fine debut from Colt McCoy. Georgia, 34-7, not quite as sharp on offense as perhaps Texas. They're winning 34-7 in the third.
It was big for Texas to have Colt McCoy have a big day going into next week's game against Ohio State in Austin.
You'll see that Virginia Tech team here on ESPN at noon next Saturday against North Carolina. Six sacks now for Michigan. Leon Hall, the cornerback, taking down Chris Nixon.
Leon Hall gets chopped, but the ground is fire. He gets right back up and makes the play. Don't lay on the ground. And there's Ron English, defensive coordinator. He's got to be excited about the performance of his guys. He's playing a lot of people.
Nice way to debut. Hold the opponent to 7 points. And 154 yards right now for Vandy. Low throw down on a knee to catch it. Earl Bennett, but he's inbound short of the first down, and the clock will run. Under a minute before they snap it again, in all likelihood, 5 yard gain. Well, it doesn't get much easier for Bobby Johnson, if at all. They'll be at Alabama next Saturday. And they're home to play their first home game of the year in Nashville against Arkansas. Three very tough games. They gave up their traditional game with Middle Tennessee State to play this game on national television. A chance for the exposure, trying to build off the gains of the exposure last year. With the winning came 4 games on the ESPN family of networks, and Bobby said that really helped in their recruiting.
And that's why you see a lot of mid-game weeks on the family of network, because of the opportunity for coaches to showcase their school and their talent.
Nixon got hammered by Crable as he threw the ball behind George Smith.
One thing about Chris Nixon, I believe he has a bright future, Sean, and he's getting invaluable experience working a 2-minute drill here. Short time drill, but this has been the scene all day. Leon Hall, you know, in the NFL, that might have been 15 right there, because he led with his head. To me, it looked clean, but I'm just saying, sometimes those referees, see, that's a nice little headbutt there. He led with his face. See what you hit, hit what you see.
On second down, the pass incomplete. It hasn't been the starting debut that Nixon has hoped for, but they believe he has a bright future. He certainly has left his mark wherever he's been. Great player in high school in Alabama and a great citizen. As the mayor of Brundage, Alabama, James Ramage, said he's a great person, very smart, personable. Everybody in town knows him and likes him. When the mayor knows, I guess it's only 2,300. That's still a pretty big deal.
The mayor wants votes. He's not going to get behind that favorite son there.
The antique city, Brundage, Alabama. Mayor Ramage said, we're Mayberry with a football team. It's a small town. Good football team, though, at Pike County when Nixon was there and led them to a state championship. He visited Vanderbilt the same weekend as Pat White. Of course, White committed to LSU, then went to West Virginia. Similar styles of play for Nixon and White. Both excellent runners, but able to throw well as well.
Hope Barney isn't the head coach down there at Mayberry. They have some problems with some calls, I think.
Fourth down. And an incomplete pass. Perhaps a fitting ending for the Vandy offense, Reese.
It is indeed been a tough day for the Vanderbilt offense, Sean, and also a tough day for Michigan State against Idaho. Spartans are trying to salt this thing away. Still a little time left in the fourth. They're up 24-17 on the Vandals. And Purdue having its hands full with the Sycamores of Indiana State, and Larry Bird's nowhere to be found. 33-21 in the third.
First and 10, Michigan.
About Carl Nix.
Jason Forcier, the backup quarterback, is in to hand it off to Brandon Miner. And that's the last play of the game. A workmanlike victory for Lloyd Carr. Happy to survive against this game opponent. Get that first win in the satchel, but also plenty of coaching points
as they work with their players to get ready for Central Michigan. Final score, Michigan 27 and Vanderbilt 7. The State Farm Classic LPGA Tour action coming up next. Now for Chris Spielman, Rob Stone, and our ESPN crew, Sean McDonough saying, good afternoon from Ann Arbor, Michigan. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports.
Coming up on Michigan Replay, the Wolverines open up strong with a win over Vanderbilt. We'll have the highlights. We'll also meet two new coaches at Michigan who are not strangers to Michigan. And we'll look ahead to next week as we scout Central Michigan. All that and more coming up next. Michigan Replay with Lloyd Carr is brought to you in part by Diet Mountain Dew. How do does diet? By Pontiac, official performance machines of Michigan and the NCAA. By Gatorade Thirst Quencher. Gatorade, is it in you? By LaSalle Bank, proud to support the University of Michigan football program. LaSalle Bank, making more possible. And by Big Boy Restaurants. Oh boy, Big Boy, celebrating 70 years as your hometown family restaurant.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Michigan Replay. The Wolverines open the 2006 season with a victory over Vanderbilt at home, 27-7. Congratulations, Coach. Well done.
Well, it's good to get out of the gate on a good note, Jim.
The thing about the game, and correct me if I'm wrong, I think Vanderbilt may have been underestimated by some out there. I thought defensively, they're a pretty scrappy little team.
Well, they're well coached. They're a team that defensively doesn't want to give you a big play and force you to execute, and one of the issues we had in this game was we didn't do some of the things we're capable of doing, but there's a lot of very, very good things, positive things come out of this game.
One of the positive things that we should all talk, how do you like the new set? Huh?
I love it.
Isn't this cool?
I love it.
They actually spent some money on this show finally.
Well, they should.
As you deserve.
As you have made this the highest rated show.
No. You guys, all you guys.
Well, Bob Lipson and this crew, we got a great crew, and we're ready to go.
Well, the set is new, and it's a good one, and we like it, and we hope it's here for many years. And getting back to the game real quickly, their secondary was fast and everything, but it was clear when you came out of the gate, you wanted to pound the ball and run it.
Well, Jim, we talked about getting off to a fast start, and certainly we did that. We could not have asked more of our offense and our defense in that first quarter.
Well, the whole key again, I think, was your commitment to the run.
Well, the left side of the line here, tight end Tyler Ecker, and we get movement off the line of scrimmage, which is what you want to do. I think we did that a lot of this day, and here the play action pass set up by the pass, great throw by Chad, and Steve gets his feet down in bounds, and we're on a roll.
And again, here comes Mike Hart. And this is one of those plays where Mike is so good with his vision at seeing the crease.
The thing he does so well is he makes a lot of people bring the safeties down, and he has a great ability to make the safeties miss.
Then you get your first score from Kevin Grady.
Well, we run over there behind Alex Mitchell and Reuben Riley and Obi Alebo, and good movement. He cuts it back, makes a good cut, and we're in the lead.
7-0 at this point. Then your defense forces their quarterback to run, and it creates turnover.
Well, Alan Branch hustling from the backside gets his hand in there and knocks the ball loose. And so we with very good hustle to the football, we come up with a big turnover.
And you talked that Chad Henney's a little bit more mobile this year also. He's lost some weight.
Well, he has, and I think he's made some very good plays. He avoided several sacks, Jim, because of his movement.
Drive stalls, you get a field goal from Garrett Revis, and at this point, still in the first quarter, you've got a 10-0 lead over the Commodores.
Well, we're playing well defensively, and we feel very good about being able to have established the running game.
Showing off a young freshman back in Brandon Miner here.
Well, Brandon Miner, again, off the left side over there, a guy that's got very, very good vision, very good maturity. I think he's going to play an important role in this on this team.
And this block kick was kind of a momentum turner, wasn't it?
Well, it always is, Jim. It gives Vanderbilt great field position. Instead of being up 13-0, we're 10-0, and they've got great field position. And they put together a decent drive here, hitting their young wide receiver for a big first down on third down.
And then they got a kind of a trick play touchdown here.
Well, you see the ball is thrown backwards, and our young corner, Charles Stewart, he'll learn from this play, but when the ball is thrown backwards, you've got to stay back in your zone. He reacted to the football, and of course, in that situation, it wasn't the right thing to do.
It's a 10-7 game at that point. Your next possession, you come back and Steve Preston does what Steve Preston does.
Well, he made something out of nothing there. Normally, when you cut back against the defense that far, you're going to lose yardage.
Adrian Arrington here getting a chance. Good running there.
I was very excited at this play because I think Adrian had a miserable experience a year ago, missing the season with an injury, but he made a very good run there, and he's going to get better as the season goes on. Here, we give up a sack, and fortunately, Garrett Rivas hits his longest field goal of his career. We get good protection, and coming off that block earlier, that gave us a big lift.
13-7 lead at that point. Still, before half, the defense continues to pound away.
Well, Rondell Biggs, who had such a wonderful junior year up until the Michigan State game where he got hurt and was never quite sane the rest of the year, had some big plays there. And of course, I think Lamar got off to a great start, made a lot of big plays. He made life miserable for that quarterback.
At halftime, you got the 13-7 lead. Talk to me about going in at half. Was there any concern on your part that you had wasted some opportunities there to maybe put the game away?
Well, I think, you know, we were dominating the game from the standpoint we had established a good running game. We were playing excellent defense, and yet we'd had a blocked kick. We'd had a couple of penalties. We turned the football over.
So you weren't very happy.
No.
Mean, you were going to the locker room a little bit steamy.
Well, you know, the we had guys that are very, very good football players that made mistakes, and it seemed like it was one after another. We stopped ourselves, Jim. And all we had to do was go in there and settle down and come out and play like we're capable.
Well, in the second half, the Wolverines did get it done. We'll be back. We'll have those highlights. But first, we hear from Alex Mitchell saying it's all about a ground attack.
We came out with the mentality to run the ball. That's what we did. We ran the ball. That's what we've been practicing for all summer, all spring.
Michigan Replay and Al Rose Steel take you inside the locker room.
We knew the quarterback could run, and he tried to run a little more than we thought, so we figured as long as we keep him inside and, you know, we get let our D lineman run to him, you know, and just keep our leverage, then we'll beat him up. And he gave us the ball a couple of times, so it was like, you know, the philosophy works.
Well, the defense was outstanding against Vanderbilt on Saturday. Sean Crable talking about the defense. And when you come out of the locker room with just that 13-7 lead, you've got to go on defense right away. And I'm sure you told them, we want a three and out.
Well, we were kicking off into the wind because of the fourth quarter situation. But I think all day long, Sean Crable hit it right on the head there, Jim. We did not let Hickson outside, and the pursuit was able to hold him to some minimum.
And you were worried about him coming into the game.
He is a great athlete, and I think our defense did a great job on him today.
Well, opening up the second half, this is a short yardage play that they're trying to keep the ball, and you just stuff it.
Jim, a great individual effort by Rondell Biggs, who was running an inside move, got penetration, and we forced them to punt. We get the ball back.
Then you get working on the ground again. Mike Hart gets inside. Here's a 4th-and-1 call. You go for it.
Well, Obi Olebo in there does a great job blocking. Come off the left side. Kevin did a great job getting his pads down and getting the first down.
And here's your second touchdown. Great catch.
Play action. We held the linebacker. It's a tough throw because you got to get it high enough to get it over the safety. But before he gets out of bounds, Tyler Ecker extended, made a great catch, and we needed that touchdown to give us some security here.
20-7 at the end of the third quarter. Here you go into the fourth. The defense continues to play strong.
Well, a wonderful penetration there by Lamar Woodley, and Rondell makes another play.
And here Nixon forced to run again, and you turn it over.
Brandon Engelman there again from the backside is pursuing the play, and great hustle, and we come up with not only the football, but great field position late in the game.
And to put it away, you go to Mario Manningham, who makes a couple of great plays.
Well, you know, Jim, we missed a couple of plays that would have been big plays early in the game. It was great. Chad threw a great strike there, and he came right back here and hits Mario for a touchdown. And that's the way you want to end the game, because we had some stretches in there where we didn't execute like we'd like to.
27-7 at this point, and then the defense appropriately puts it away. Great play by Leon Hall here.
Again, you let that quarterback outside. Leon was on the ground. He got up off the ground, hustled, maintained leverage, made a big play. So they're talking about leverage on the football. They did a great job.
Go back a little bit earlier. The 4th-and-1 play down close. Was there any hesitation on your part to maybe kick the field goal, or did you felt that we were close enough, you had to pound that in there? You needed more breathing room.
Well, we were into the wind, but I never hesitated because I felt like we needed to score a touchdown. We'd been running the ball effectively, and our line did a great job, but that was a big play in the game.
This is a good opener, isn't it? Because you win the game, and yet there's a lot of coaching points that you can talk about. After the game, you spoke about your protection schemes and that needs to get shored up, things like that. So you've got a lot of work ahead, but you still come out of there with a win, and you're feeling good and confident going into game two.
Well, over a very competitive team, Jim, I think we can come out of this game as a team knowing that there's things that we can correct, and yet there's also things that we feel good about. But the truth is that you got to get better every week, and certainly we can go into this week knowing that there's a lot of things to work on. I think attitudinally, that's a good position to be in.
If there was one area of the game I think you had to be really pleased with, I think the defensive front truly controlled the offensive front of Vanderbilt. They were dominant.
Well, there's no question that, you know, that's one of the strengths of our team. I was extremely happy the way they played. And we've got good depth. We rotated a lot of guys in there. Tim Jamison will be back this week. So we had a lot of guys get some experience, and we did have some great play up front.
27-7, the final. Michigan beats Vanderbilt in their opener. When we come back, we'll move on and meet a couple of new coaches who actually know a lot about the Wolverines. But first, we hear from Lamar Woodley. He talks about playing together as a team makes it a whole lot easier on the defense.
All 11 guys on the defense doing their job. I mean, then it's hard to do things. When everybody's out there communicating, it's hard for an offense to get going.
There are two new additions to the 2006 Michigan coaching staff, and both of them have, in their past, been on the other sidelines coaching against Michigan. Cornerbacks coach Ron Lee arrives in Ann Arbor from Wisconsin. He walks into Michigan well aware that last year's 7-5 record is not good enough at Michigan, and he senses in this team a sense of unfinished business.
Well, I know it's unexpected here. That's not supposed to happen, to go 7-5. You can feel the energy. I mean, the first day on the job, from Coach Carr to the janitor, you know, everyone is fired up and everyone has a purpose now. And now we've got to have the plan and build a solid foundation so when we get into those games, those things don't happen.
Lee's duties are the cornerbacks and cornerbacks only. He's not in charge of the entire secondary. To him, that's a great coaching move and will lead to more efficient play.
17 years of coaching, I've been just in the back end by myself, and you know, the game has evolved from a traditional eye set to four or five wide receivers at a time. So a secondary coach can go from coaching four guys to sometimes six guys. So it allows us to individualize coaching for that position instead of running around and trying to get six things done at one time.
Michigan's other newcomer is Steve Sabo, a veteran of 37 years in the business. He arrives from the NFL and the Buffalo Bills. And the difference between the NFL player and the college player appeals to his teacher's mentality.
First off, you're working with a different style of guy. You know, the guys in the NFL have played a lot of football. And so they're kind of set in their ways. That's the nicest thing about college. I mean, you have more of an impact on these guys, and they listen to everything you say, and they will try to do it like you want them to do it, you know, without any hesitation. And that is really a neat thing.
Sabo also just happens to be a past coach at Ohio State. By taking this job at Michigan, he admits it did get the attention of his former Buckeye brethren.
One of the first ones was from Earl Bruce, who is still a good friend. He just couldn't believe, how could you do that? But hey, I explained to him, I thought this is a tremendous opportunity. And the biggest thing for me is I've known Lloyd for many years. I have tremendous respect for him, and you know, I've from afar watched the program again with respect. So the opportunity to come here, I thought, was excellent.
Both new coaches, Coach Carr and Sabo, comes, he brings an NFL kind of a thing with him also. Kids know that he's got some NFL experience, so what he says, they listen to.
Well, he's been with some great football coaches, Tom Coughlin, Bill Belichick, Earl Bruce, of course, and he's had a lot of responsibility. He's been a defensive coordinator, and I think our players really like him. He's a wonderful teacher. He's got a way that he's able to get his point across.
How about from the other side? Did you get any heat when people looked at his resume and saw Ohio State on it?
No, I never thought about it, and I don't think it was important. But Ron Lee, of course, coached last. He's been at Wisconsin. Barry
he coached
Alvarez.
For Barry Alvarez. He's a good friend of yours.
Yeah, and Barry had great recommendation. And Ron is, of course, from the West Coast. He played at Washington State. Got a wonderful family. So both of those guys have fit in really well.
And I really think smart move, putting him in charge of just the corners. Because he explained it. He said, now with the offenses with five detached receivers, you might have four or five corners in the game at one time.
Well, I think it's something, that is only going to help us as we go into this season, because you're exactly right, Jim. It's a different game. It used to be two backs in the backfield, two tight ends, and one wide receiver. Well, now those days are gone.
Forever, I think.
Forever.
When we come back, we will look ahead and scout Central Michigan. But first, we hear from Michael Hart, who says, hey, don't take the Chippewas lightly.
Central's a great team. You know, they almost beat Boston College the other day. They should have beat Boston College the other day. And, you know, they're a great team offensively. They're explosive defensively. That, you know, they like to hit. They're not afraid. And that's the biggest thing with them. They're not going to be afraid to come in here and play. So they're coming here to beat us, so we got to be prepared for them.
Michigan Replay and Al Rose Steel take you inside the locker room.
Coach Stripp did a great job coaching him. Got great games. We got athletic people like Prescott, Sean Crable coming in there blitzing. Great packages, you know, so we out here. We going to get it done.
The defense is going to have to get it done against Central Michigan because, Lloyd, the Chippewas come in. They gave Boston College a pretty good run the other night, and they run the spread offense.
Well, Jim, they're a potent offensive football team. Brian Kelly has won at least two national championships at Grand Valley State, and has a good, talented football team to work with.
31-24 they lost to Boston College last Thursday night. They gave Boston College a good run. LeFevre's their quarterback, and really he can get the job done. And Ontario Sneed is their running back, who you like a lot and you think his guy can play.
Well, he gained 1,000 yards a year ago, and I think LeFevre has shown excellent mobility, and that makes a real difference in this offense. So along with Damian Linson, their wide receiver, they can spread you out, make a lot of good things happen.
One of the things that, you know, sometimes you see problems with MAC teams is on their defensive side of the ball, but they've got big-time defensive end in Daniel Bazine.
Jim, great football player. He's going to play on Sundays. He is one of those guys that has developed into a great player. He's going to get high consideration for the Mid-American Conference Player of the Year Award.
Red Keith is their outstanding linebacker inside, and Ike Brown also gives them two linebackers who can really make plays.
Rod Keith had 15 tackles about against BC on Thursday night. So, this is a football team that will come excited to play, and we got to be ready. We got to get better. We got to worry about us and do the things that we need to do to improve.
When you say you got to get better and you'll worry about you, I understand that's true. The other thing is, when you look at a team like a Central Michigan coming in, do you think they gain some confidence playing a BC, a Big East school, and actually, you know, making a move with them? Do you think they gain confidence coming in after a game like that?
I don't think there's any doubt, because, Jim, they know and they believe they should have won that game, or at least sent it into overtime, because they dropped the ball down inside the 10-yard line. They had some opportunities. So there's no question they'll come out of there feeling very, very good about themselves. And, you know, I think we're all in the same position who have won their opener. You know that you've got to get better. You're going to have made some mistakes, but you can go in with some confidence because you won.
From your perspective now, talking about the Michigan team, that you've got to improve, what area do you look at this week as an area in practice that you're going to focus?
Well, we're going to focus on trying to cut out the penalties, because that is one of the most disturbing things in that game. We had some penalties we just should not have. And we've got to improve our pass protection. There's no way that we can have people running through into the backfield unmolested.
But you will still commit
to run to the
ball. Well,
I know
you will, or will have me to contend with.
I'm glad you and Bo are happy. And,
we were happy.
But I'm happy, too.
Like this, when you put up over 200 yards on the ground, that's acceptable.
Well, absolutely. And so we can feel good about that part of it. Now, we've got to hit some passes and do the things that we're capable of doing. Guys that have the ability to make those plays, we got to make them.
Yeah, and down the road, we're going to talk about some of the rule changes, including the timing situation. That's going to be an interesting topic. But for now, that's it. Make sure to join us next week on Michigan Replay when we get the Central Michigan Chippewas. Same time, same place, right here on Michigan Replay.
Michigan Replay has been brought to you in part by Absopure Water, delivering quality bottled water since 1908. By Sirius Satellite Radio. By the University of Michigan Alumni Association, uniting the leaders and best, www.umalumni.com. By State Farm, providing insurance and financial services. And by Pontiac, official performance machines of Michigan and the NCAA.